is a special presentation of CBC Sports.
But Mike, if I come to you once the player performs better than Smolensky, Stumpel, Niedermayer, Kozlov, Alfredsson, and Sanderson.
Yeah, but see, I don't care what they got. You keep coming back to the marketplace, and I keep coming back to my team.
You only go through this career once, so you can't afford to screw up. You can't afford to be making mistakes.
We're going to keep growing the game and making it bigger and better. And as the money grows here, don't change.
I want to be in a position to average out 1-5.
Jesus Christ.
You're fighting for a job here, and unless we see you be more assertive, you're going to Kentucky Friday morning.
Why, Pinch? Why? You got no chance to get the puck anyways.
Maybe it is time to think about two officials and one linesman.
Should have a Canadian division.
That's right.
Canadian guys up there.
That'll do it.
If we continue to grow, then our shot in the barrel will come also.
Every year, for more than 70 years, for general managers, team owners, and players alike, the National Hockey League season has come down to this.
Hey, excuse me. Coming in with you.
The Stanley Cup is the oldest championship trophy in professional team sports. It's still the fulfillment of a childhood dream. It can still cap off a Hall of Fame career. But now, getting here takes 12 long months. And what the Cup represents has changed. In today's NHL, contending for the Stanley Cup and turning a profit are linked as never before. Winning teams have to figure out how to go on winning. Losing teams better figure out how to start.
And now, hockey fans, let's have a rousing Pittsburgh welcome for National Hockey League Commissioner Gary Bettman.
We are thrilled to be in Pittsburgh with our fans at the Pittsburgh Civic Arena. The reception for the entry draft and to league personnel and our top prospects here in West Virginia.
Just a week after the Stanley Cup final, the league's annual entry draft gets underway. Already, the next season, the new season, has begun.
Right now, it doesn't look like there'll be any movement on the picks, but I think we're going to wait right until the fourth pick is there. That's when I think we may have a little bit of action. My hopes are already so high, just making a pick at 4 and making a pick at 5.
I'm actually feel better now because our list is the way we want the players taken. And I didn't like Longo not being on the list. So if it comes to 6, and he's there, we're
like,
thinking.
Are you going to tell him who we're taking? Who we're thinking of?
No.
I just say, we'll tell you at our
pick. Okay. I mean, what if it's just Kristich for our 8? Would you do that? Kristich, and they're 15 for our 8.
Hockey normally gets played in this arena. Today, it's a different game. The league's 26 teams are facing off against each other. Over 500 top NHL decision makers are here. Each team stands in the other team's way. There's a lot of strategy and chance involved. The stakes are high.
Franchise now in the league are worth $80-85 million US, and the players are probably worth at least $60-65 million of that. Each individual draft is probably worth $5 million to the franchise. And so today, we've got an asset of $5 million that we're investing. But even those late picks that are, you know, asset-wise are probably worth $100,000 today, if you make a good pick, it becomes a lot more. That decision in the 8th round or 7th round, what today is an asset of $100,000 maybe, could become $1 million. So it's important.
246 prospects will be selected in this year's draft. Joe Thornton of St. Thomas, Ontario, is guaranteed to go first overall. The Boston Bruins want him so much, they've already begun contract talks. Thornton is worth more than $1 million right now. According to NHL Central Scouting, the young Canadian possesses all the physical and mental elements needed to become a dominant NHL player. A gifted playmaker, Thornton not only patterns himself after Wayne Gretzky, he has the great one's agent representing him.
You were asking us last night.
Number six?
About the number.
Yeah. Hey, it's fine with me.
Don't, listen, yeah. Don't do it if you don't want
yeah.
to.
Like,
yeah. You got to feel really comfortable with it.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, people that have been around the game longer, I can tell you, combination, you got your look now.
Yeah.
You're making a statement like Gretzky
yeah.
when he came
yeah.
with the hair. Now you got
yeah.
a number that's
got,
identifiable.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
You know?
Five for Chris? You only wanted five for Chris?
Chris Madden wants five. Mom. Grandma's got hers.
Grandma has hers.
Just 17 years old, Joe has an entourage of 30 people to look after here this weekend. Named the league's top prospect at Christmas, in the hockey world, Joe Thornton is already a household name.
Thank you, sir.
Like Mario Lemieux, Eric Lindros, and other number one picks before him, Thornton may one day be the kind of player who can carry an entire franchise. For now, he is the only teenager in the draft who knows how this day will go.
You ready, Mom?
Yep.
That tie's not straight, Mom.
Here. None of the other top-ranked prospects know exactly how they stack up. Russian-born Sergei Samsonov is one of them. Yesterday, he was interviewed by more scouts from more teams than he can remember.
We're picking sixth in the draft, okay? Well, Boston picks first. I think they're going to take Joe Thornton. You probably heard of all these guys.
Yeah.
The pressure of playing in Montreal. You're going to the corner store, and someone tells you, Sergei, you're no good. How would you react to that?
Just doesn't say anything.
Would you try and prove him wrong the next time?
Maybe I'm nice, but not in the story, no.
Tell us about yourself, what your strengths are, and what you could bring to the Boston Bruins.
I'm kind of a offensive player.
Last year, Sergei led the Detroit Vipers to a championship in the International Hockey League. A natural goal scorer, he was named IHL Rookie of the Year.
Team that's in the United States.
Well, it doesn't matter to me.
The big knock against Samsonov is his size. He stands just 5'8". Can he make the necessary adjustments?
Two things would concern us. Number one, can the opposition intimidate you, like scare you off playing your game? And the other thing is, if they put a good checker on you, can they prevent you from scoring? I've seen you play a lot. I don't think the National League guys will scare you. But what happens when you're really being checked close? Are you going to be able to keep playing your game?
Sure. Well, I guess it's the only way for me.
See, I think the big thing, Sergei, if you get into the National League is you're not going to get 10 scoring chances a game. You've got to continue to play hard, continue to play smart, wait for your opportunities, and you might get 3 or 4 chances.
Move up.
Oh.
Good job.
Joe Thornton's size helped get him here. At 6'4" and 198 pounds, he is still growing.
All right, Joe. How'd it go?
What are the league's general managers looking for this year? Is it scoring or playmaking ability? Is it size or speed? Sergei Samsonov and the others will just have to wait and see.
NHL on CBC, brought to you by Bell, connecting you to the people, places, and things that matter. And by Ford, for now, forever.
And to all our fans back in Long Island, we hope you're enjoying this day as much as we are. We are proud to select, with the fourth selection, Roberto Luongo from Val-d'Or.
Joe Thornton to Boston, Patrick Marleau to San Jose, Olli Jokinen to L.A. The first three picks go pretty much as expected. Then, New York Islander general manager Mike Milbury makes things interesting.
Congratulations, kid.
You stay there.
The fourth pick, Roberto Luongo, could be a franchise player. But the next pick, the fifth pick, belongs to Milbury, too. He lets it be known that one is up for grabs.
Well, want to talk about anything now, or should just move on?
Got to wait now, Mike, I guess. Just got to wait it out, okay. Buddy.
Draft picks are risky propositions. They may not prove out for years. But a veteran NHL player can help a team right now.
I'm just looking for any other option that wasn't going to do it for us.
Tampa Bay GM Phil Esposito has just the guy Milbury wants. Yeah. Jason Weaver.
No, that's not going to do it for me.
I know you won't leave it to anybody else besides Weaver, Mike.
Tuck, I'm going to take a timeout. I got to milk this for all the TV we can get anyway.
Okay.
The sixth pick of the draft belongs to Calgary.
Going back up?
Not yet.
Flames GM Al Coates wants Daniel Tkachuk. Now he's worried Melbury might let Tampa Bay get there first.
You want to give up a fourth round pick or a sixth round pick or something like that? For them not to take the switch?
We get Weimer and we have to give up something else. We're just trying to figure out what else we'd give up. Did you give up Cruz?
To sweeten the deal, Melbury is prepared to throw in one of his current players.
Cruz, Anderson, did you give up Holland?
He had to be impressed that the guy walked in the room. He was huge. He was huge. Sam Stanley.
The Boston Bruins have the eighth pick. They want Sergei Samsonov. But they're worried Calgary or the Islanders or even Tampa Bay might get him first.
Everyone's been reading about this kid for 2 years.
Yeah.
You think they're gonna nail him?
You guys like Cruz at all?
Not really, no. No, we're not.
What kind of a pick could I give you? You got Dallas' third?
For Weimer?
We swapped.
Yeah.
We got Weimer, and I'll give you Dallas' third.
I don't think so, Mike. We've got to keep Weimer. The new owners want to keep him. That's why I wouldn't want to trade him.
Okay. Thank you.
The Islander Lightning deal is no go, but Milbury could still pick a player the other teams want.
All right, let's do it. Delayed it.
So we're going to do nothing.
They're making this thing look too complicated.
How nice of you to come again.
In the end, Milbury's pick poses no problems for the others.
New York Islanders are proud to select from Prince George Eric Brewer.
New York Islanders select.
The sixth pick goes Al Coates' way.
Calgary is proud to select from the Barrie Colts of the Ontario Hockey League, Daniel Tkachuk.
The seventh pick, Tampa Bay, suits Boston's Mike O'Connell just fine.
Mara. Well, now we're off the hook for that one, too. You know, people in Boston, geez, you couldn't get Mara down.
Yeah.
For the Bruins, the number eight pick is a no-brainer.
Detroit Vipers, Sergei Samsonov.
Can you give me a jacket before you go up?
Sergei, Harry Sinden.
Congratulations. We're happy to have you.
Okay.
He arrived in North America speaking no English at the age of 16. He came with his father, who looked after him and cooked all his meals.
Congratulations. Welcome to the NHL.
Thanks.
Sergei's mother and younger brother did not come over until much later. Today, it all seems worth it.
Slide down.
Here you go, Sergei.
Right on the tape.
There we go.
Sergei Samsonov.
Wait. All right. Can't play my game and most important thing.
Tomorrow, hockey reporters across North America will spread the news about a young Russian boy made good. There are plenty of other success stories here this afternoon.
There we are. Geez, you look good in that uniform, I'm telling you. You look great.
School boys yesterday. They are valuable assets now. The draft is over in less than 6 hours, but questions remain.
Congratulations.
Will they make it to the NHL?
All right. Did you meet Yuri?
Will they even sign?
Yeah. From Moscow. We brought him for you. Maybe somebody else take you first.
Meet Joe, our other picker. Joe.
Hey. How are you?
I'm the best.
Yeah. That's great.
Yeah.
How much are the draft picks? picks really worth to the teams that select them? How much is any hockey player worth? Summer is contract signing season in the NHL. Some tough negotiations lie ahead.
Let's go.
Have fun.
It's about staring fear in the eye and not giving in. Playing past the pain and going for it all. You make it what it is and what it will become. Strength, pride, courage. It's more than just a game. It's who we are. It's who we will be. It can unite a nation and define a country. It's our game, and nobody can take that away. It's tradition. Keep it alive. The one and only Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
What do you want to start then with, a basis of three and then go to four with an option? So
well,
I think
the best way to start, Donnie, is give me an idea of what you, if you want a three-year deal, what's the package? What's the package?
Well, I want to be in a position to average out 1.5.
Jesus Christ.
Well, that's not a bad raise. That's 250%.
Well, let me talk about Barazan's situation.
In that what I would be asking would be less of an increase than on that player.
Well, in the case of Barazan,
he's got a back-end loaded contract, which is a contract that we had to pay to get a goal scorer on our team, which lacks goal scoring at this juncture.
My problem, Don, very simply, at $1.5 million, is that I cannot pay Ty Domi $1.5 million for the role that he fills. I could
if he were a free agent. And I probably would. But I can't. It's a very simple matter of economic principle. I more than anyone appreciate what Ty Domi does for this team. I think you know that. But $1.5 million is outlandish for him.
If this year's top draft picks ever get the kind of money they and their agents are looking for, they will have a number of people to thank. Ty Domi, a 7-year NHL veteran, is a fan favorite in Toronto, and scoring goals has little to do with it. To back up his salary demands, his agents employ a relatively new technique. They compare Ty Domi to another Leaf player, rookie Sergei Berezin. Berezin is paid to score goals. Domi isn't, but that doesn't seem to matter.
Berezin and Domi are not comparables. In all due respect to both parties, they are not comparables.
But,
if you're going to compare Domi to Bob Probert...
Bill,
are you telling me that 41 points to 28 points,
no,
there's no relevance?
No, I'm talking about the type of player involved and the need that he fills. If you want to stick to the 28 over 41, then let's make a deal.
I'll stick to this, Bill. Ty Domi had 25 even strength points. Barazan had 29. Brings the distinction down to 4 points when they're on the ice on a 5-on-5 basis.
28 is to 42. It's 41. But 28 is to 42.
Yeah, but hold on
that's
now.
4 is to 6. That's 2 is to 3.
That's
and so way. Unless we're going to drop the Barazan story, let's stick to the numbers.
No, I'm not prepared to let you just draw the distinction or the analogy on 41 to 28.
Because what do you do in relation to the 275 minutes?
Oh, no. Hey, I look at my lineup. I'll find somebody to get 275 minutes. I don't want it to get to that, Don.
I know, but I don't want to have to be you to tell the Toronto community that you'll get somebody else to do it as well as he does it.
Do you think Gino Wojcik doesn't do it better than Ty Domi or as good?
No, he doesn't.
Okay.
Pat Quinn would take Ty Domi in the drop of a hat.
Yeah, well.
And you know that as well as I do.
That's not the function here. The function here is to make a deal. You want 1.5, you're not going to get it. I want $1 million, I'm not going to give it.
Bill, I know you too long, and I know the Barazan deal hurts you people as a comparable. One guy got 41 points, one guy got 28 points. The guy who got 28 is a regular. He's the best at what he does in the league today, and you're saying to me he should take $600,000 less.
No, you don't have to take anything.
Well, I know, but he's not going to. As much as you can say to me, we're not going to pay it. You've got a problem on your hands because you've set a precedent on Berezin. Like it or not, he's there.
Colorado's Joe Sakic assigning bonus of $15 million U.S. Philadelphia's Chris Gratton a $9 million signing bonus. The average NHL journeyman a salary of well over $1 million a year. And Toronto player agent Don Meehan, with 90 players in his stable, doesn't see a problem.
If you're suggesting that the amount of money that the players are earning is bad for the game, then I think that would be improper. It would be foolish to say that because if you're an owner or a manager, you simply don't have to pay the players. If it didn't make sense, then you wouldn't pay them. And yet they're paying them all.
Team owners and general managers feel trapped. Full player salary disclosure has been a common league practice since 1990. Everyone knows what everyone else is making now. GMs who fail to pay the going rate risk having a losing team on the ice and all the fan and media discontent that goes along with it. Harry Sinden has seen trends he liked more.
It's easy to sign a player. You just give them what they want. But it's another question to fight for what's fair and what's right and try to keep your teams, you know, profitable. That's part of what you're doing as a manager is managing the owner's money. And we're running out of money because we're giving it all to the players.
Even if collusion were legal, it has become increasingly hard to pull off. The GMs compete against one another. The pressure they feel to win, whatever the cost, is growing.
But Mike, if I come to you once the player performs better than Smolinski, Stumpel, Niedermeyer, Kozlov, Alfredson, and Sanderson.
Yeah, but see, I don't care what they got. You keep coming back to the marketplace, and I keep coming back to my team. I value Smolinski slightly ahead of Travis Green. I value Travis Green. But I can't dictate what they're doing in around the league. I can't. I mean, can you recognize my situation?
But I have to have a salary structure that reflects my own economics. We are not the New York Rangers, and we are not the Philadelphia Flyers. We're in desperate need of a new building. Our attendance has been down for good reason. The team's not been good. But just because Victor Kozlov is going to get $2 million, or Daniel Alfredson is going to get $2 million. I don't care if their statistics are identical. It doesn't make economic sense for me.
Increasingly, teams that don't pay top dollar are at risk of becoming farm systems for teams that do. Once they're free agents, established players are happy to go where the bigger money is. The Toronto Maple Leafs are hoping they have done enough to keep one of their stars from eventually packing his bags.
There are some GMs, when they get wind of this number, are going to be havoc. $7,150,000 for 5 years. Now that breaks down to $1,430,000 a year. All right, pretty close to that 1.5 that we felt it would take to do a deal. And it's very much like Berezin. He starts off at 8, he goes to 1. He goes to 1.2, he goes to 1.4, and then he goes to 1.750 plus 4 in signing in the fifth year. Now, there's another thing that we haven't talked about today. There probably hasn't been an individual like you who does what you do that at a certain point in time loses a real zeal to do that. It doesn't become so much fun. And it's not easy what you do, and that's how we're commanding this kind of money. We wouldn't have a chance in hell of getting these numbers with 99% of the teams in the league. Because much due to your own strength of how popular you are in this community.
This is all U.S.
We still have this same thing.
Yeah.
The same fifth year.
Yeah.
Guaranteed.
Yeah.
And the sixth year is an option like the fifth year.
The sixth year, he's talking about $1.9 million.
Let's get it on.
At the Boston Bruins head office, Harry Sinden faces growing attendance problems at the newly built Fleet Center if he doesn't sign Joe Thornton. Against his better judgment, Sinden feels compelled to fall in line.
We're guilty of behaving in the same manner that many, many teams behave, because in effect, we gave them what they wanted. We set the number, it was around $2.5 million a year. It was way too much money, but this was a pure case of selfishness on the Bruins' part. The demands of our fans were such that we were gonna pay, even though no rookie should get that kind of money.
The Thornton contract sets a clear precedent for Boston's other top prospect, Sergei Samsonov.
If Joe were to achieve two out of these six criteria, Calder first through fifth, rookie of the year, 20 goals or more, 35 or more assists, 60 or more points. If he gets two out of the six for this level of performance, it puts him in a category of $2.5 million. And our feeling is that if he's in a situation where he gets $800,000 for scoring 20 goals and or 35 assists or 60 points, then you should get the same.
Tomorrow on...
To the Gemini rehearsal.
This is serious
play.
Award stuff.
The World Series trophy stays in Cooperstown, New York during the off-season. The NFL's Vince Lombardi trophy stays in Canton, Ohio. The NBA's Larry O'Brien trophy stays in Springfield, Massachusetts. But not the Stanley Cup. It spends every summer on the road. Everyone associated with the winning team gets to keep the cup for 2 days of the year. The name of every member of the winning team is engraved upon it.
And I go dancing for us.
What really makes it special to me, and I think what really defines our sport, is the fact that we can share our trophy with our friends and our family. I'd especially like to thank you.
For the next 3 months, the cup is the exclusive property of the Detroit Red Wings. They are free to do with it what they want.
You never dare to breathe. You never dare the stars. Am I supposed to even say, suppose I even say, I see
okay. I get the sweep of the away I go.
Been overseas before, but never to Russia. This year, former Soviet stars Vyacheslav Fedosov, Igor Larionov, and Vyacheslav Kozlov have earned the right to bring the cup home. When they arrive in Moscow's Lushniki Stadium, they are greeted by 100,000 Russian fans. President Boris Yeltsin among them. But summer only lasts so long. Already other players, unproven players, are working hard to take the cup away.
You might think you're good. You might be projected to be good, but you're only good on paper. There's nothing that guarantees you anything. People your age, you should get better every shift, every period, every game, every season. That's the mentality you have to possess. It's hard to go top shelf every night. It's hard to make a great play every night. So how in the hell am I going to turn that coach on to where he wants me around? All right? Here's the way. You play above your size all the time. You go to the net all the time. That's big time. If you've got that reputation and you've got talent, you're a premier player in National Hockey.
If elite player agent Mike Barnett agrees to represent a rookie, attending Chuck Grillo's three-week hockey camp in July is a non-negotiable part of the deal.
We firmly believe that it gives them a jump when they get to their camp that many other players who are training at home in a more casual environment do not have. The benefit that they would see both in on-ice conditioning and training and in the overall experience of understanding what it takes to be a qualified NHL professional in year-round commitment. It's a major wake-up call for 17, 18-year-olds to see the way a Sergei Fedorov or a Wayne Gretzky or a Brett Hull train in the summer now when they have Stanley Cup rings on their hand, Hart trophies, Art Ross trophies, and they're still pushing themselves to degrees that the juniors never thought they were capable of doing.
Move, Thornton, move!
For rookies and veterans alike, the NHL's midsummer message is the same. Get ready. It's going to be a lot tougher than you think.
Here's his whole thing.
Keep it going.
170?
Keep it going.
One more. You got one more. Let's go. Drive. You got one more in you. One more minute. Come on.
The one wonderful thing about a training camp and about any new season is that it really is a chance to remake ourselves. That whatever it is that happened a year ago is something that can be remade again. And it's that wonderful possibility, that preparation beforehand, and getting into the swing of things early to start to write that new story.
Once training camp officially begins in early September, some basic NHL truths begin to emerge. There is only one catch with getting a performance bonus. You have to perform.
You gotta push yourselves. You gotta concentrate on what we're doing. The object is to make you tired, guys, and then make you think and make you execute when you are tired, which you are right now.
Come on, take the passes here. Warner one touches it there. It's almost in our net. Take the passes.
Lengthen your stride out, not hard, just lengthen your stride. Lengthen your stride.
If you're going to be a good player at any level, and this is the best league in the world, so you're playing with the best players in the world, you're going to come in and kick somebody off his chair. And that's the way it is. It's up to every guy here that was here before to earn and keep what's rightfully his. And it's up to every young guy to come in and take somebody's job. And that's what this game's all about.
Since 1967, and I've been here since then, I don't think we've ever been in the process of remaking this team since that year like we are this year. And I say that to stress as much as I can for those of you who haven't made it yet to the National Hockey League. There's an opportunity here that only presents itself once in a while, and it's here on this team this year. Believe me when I tell you that.
Part of Boston's rebuilding process is the team's new coach. Successful in Montreal and Toronto, Pat Burns has always been known as a tough guy. A year in broadcasting has done little to change things.
Nothing will be given to anybody here. Everything will be earned. Everything will be decided. If we think that a young player can contribute to this hockey club, will help this hockey club win hockey games, we will keep him. If we feel that he's not ready to contribute, we're not going to keep anybody just for that reason.
He's a quick little bastard too, isn't he? Whenever you draft a player and they come in, you know, you're hoping. You're really hoping that what I saw in junior or in the International League, wherever it might be, I hope what I saw, he can still do it. So when Sergei showed those flashes early, it kind of eased your mind a bit that, okay, he can do it.
Training camp is about turning bosses into believers.
Nice play. Jesus Christ, what a play. See that play?
Samsonov has been so impressive, Boston's brass are even starting to view his agent in a favorable light.
It's a tribute to Grossman that he knew his player. Grossman said, we want the same as Thornton. And I said, no, I'm not going to give you the same as Thornton. He said, Sergei's going to come to camp, and you have to pay him what you're going to give Joe, because he's going to dazzle you. So he came to camp, he dazzled us, and we signed him.
For the year's number one draft pick, it's been a different story.
We're saying to Cheesy, we should take a film of Allison, right? And show it to Thornton. So this is what you're going to be if you don't get your act with you. Sergei had an idea what it's going to be like. Joe thought he had an idea, but he didn't. Nor should he, until you go. And I think he was probably a bit surprised by the caliber, not only of the players who are stars in the National Hockey League, but players who played 2 or 3 years in the minors who are fighting to get into that position.
Despite his exceptional playmaking abilities, the Canadian boy has yet to acquire the fundamentals of the NHL game.
Well, he didn't really know how to check. He didn't understand the defensive part of the game. And I don't think he expected to be checked as hard as he was about to be. And he was never ready for the unexpected, where he'd take the puck in junior and do what he wanted with it for a while. Here, he'd take it and lose it immediately. My expectations were probably a little higher than they should have been for a player that young. You know, it's a man's game up here, and they've been playing, as I said, against boys.
You know, and maybe show him some techniques to help him, you know? Well, I hope he stays. I think if he learns to play tough, if he feels comfortable about the physical part of the game, I mean, Jesus. When he does something as a good workout, we got to make sure we tell him he had a good workout, because he's reading all this other shit in the paper. We got to make sure that he can pick the bad, but when he has a good workout, say, hey, that's a good workout. Keep it going. As a kid that young, he doesn't know.
They come to a reality of what the NHL is all about. Players reach that reality at different points. Some never reach it and some never play.
If you've got the bell first ring,
Watch the floor there. Yeah.
In Detroit's Joe Louis Arena, a special ceremony takes place before the Red Wings' first home game of the season. For the first time in 42 years, Detroit fans get to watch a Stanley Cup banner rise to the rafters.
Number
Stanley Cup is then officially taken away from last year's winners. Once more, it is up for grabs. The first game of the season is the one time in the NHL calendar year when everybody, technically at least, has the same chance.
The key is don't let your guy beat you off the boards, anybody. He's your man, you beat him off the boards.
No fancy plays through the neutral zone. Get it in deep. Set the tone right off the bat. Get the first couple, the first one. You know, that'll start pressing a little bit, and they'll try to put on the show, and we'll take advantage of that.
Come on, Pepe, strong in front. Strong in front here. All right, here we go.
In the Fleet Center, halfway through the first period, the Boston Bruins again find that last place is well within reach.
Oh, Dima, why? Why, Ben? Why? I don't understand why. Why, Pinch? Why? You got no chance to get the puck anyways. God, this don't
sound. But the new coach clearly likes Samsonov. Burns calls him Sammy and gives him a regular shift.
We gotta get to their sticks here. Christ, they've scored 3 goals because their sticks are on the ice. Get the goddamn sticks up!
The Samsonovs understand their boy may still have a lot to learn.
Stay away from it. Then the defenseman will go to you, then you can chip it off. If you stay up against the board, he's going to come to you. So get off the board a little bit. Let him come, then you can chip it off. Good job anyway.
But Sergei has made the team, and for now at least, his season looks relatively secure.
Gotta have quality passes here, boys. Quality passes.
Whenever the Thornton family arrive to see Joe, it's a coin toss whether they'll find him on the ice.
Joe Thornton, there he is.
Going to see what CL?
Burns has not been impressed with the young center's intensity. The coach wants Thornton to pick up his game, to show more commitment, more drive, and desire. Not dressed, Joe will be watching tonight's game with his father in the arena lounge. Whether he stays with the big team or heads back to the juniors is still an open question.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Stanley Cup!
But it's only September. The season is 8.5 months long. There are 82 games to go, and then the playoffs. Someone will be fired. Someone will lead his team to the Stanley Cup. Someone will retire. Someone will be named Rookie of the Year. At this point, that's about all that's certain.
We have a good game. We have a great game.
We have the greatest product in the world. We've taken it to a new level in terms of exposure, but it requires the help of the players to do commercials, to go on TV shows, to do interviews.
Part 2 of The New Ice Age, tomorrow at 9 on CBC.
I'm Peter Mansbridge, Canadian.
The New Ice Age, a year in the life of the NHL on CBC. Brought to you by Bell, connecting you to the people, places, and things that matter. And by Ford, for now, forever.
I do it because one day I'll be the best.
I do it because I want to give something back to the game.
I do it for my dad. He tells me how proud I make him.
I do it just for the fun of it.
I do it because I love the game.
Live the dream, the one and only Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. A special presentation of CBC Sports.
In my opinion, other than the obstruction that's going on, the referee's better now than it's been in 10 years. Way better. But we get in a group like this, and pretty soon one guy's got an idea that initiates a thought in someone else's mind, and we all think, we got to call more penalties. Let's get more penalties in the game. Let's get more power plays. Let's get more 5-on-3s. I mean, it's crazy. It's a great game. Fix up the obstruction. Let the players play a little bit.
You only go through this career once, so you can't afford to screw up. You can't afford to be making mistakes.
We're going to keep growing the game and making it bigger and better. And as the money grows here, don't change.
I want to be in a position to average out 1-5.
Jesus Christ.
You're fighting for a job here, and unless we see you be more assertive, you're going to Kentucky Friday morning.
Why, bitch? Why? You got no chance to get the puck anyways.
Maybe it is time to think about two officials in one line.
Should have a Canadian division.
You can write a check for about $10 million.
Yeah, that'll do it.
If we continue to grow, then our shot in the barrel will come also.
One individual whose name is Martin, he's 10 years old, and he's a huge hockey fan. Mr. Leopold, I'm a long-time hockey fan with some suggestions on how to jumpstart the franchise. Number one, choose the name the Nashville Predators. Ice Tigers sound stupid. And Fury is just plain stupid. Number two, continue the strong marketing push. Your team will not step onto the ice unless 12,000 season tickets are sold. He actually said it, and he's right. Respectfully, Martin. P.S. Keep the ticket prices low the first year, then raise them later.
Weeks into the regular season, the Dallas Stars are leading the league. But in Nashville, Tennessee, the big news is that the NHL is coming to town.
Continue to call 770 o'clock, where the lines are open right now. I can assure you, we're taking season ticket orders.
There's a lot of people that are already sold.
Craig Leopold, a multimillionaire rainware maker from Racine, Wisconsin, has paid $80 million U.S. for the franchise.
We sold 3,000 the first day. The bad news, we had 9,000 more to sell. The logo around the country, everybody stops us and say...
Now, all he needs to do is find 12,000 season ticket holders.
All right, we got hockey fans here?
Not now.
All right. Oh, I love it. That's great.
If he can't find them in the next 4 months, it means no team.
Love the T-shirt.
Hockey is relatively unknown in Tennessee, but prospective season ticket buyers have been told to expect lots of speed, drama, and excitement on ice.
Make a hit, make a play. That's hockey. Go to the back door, Kelly!
Hey!
This season is a special season for the NHL. NHL players will be at the Winter Olympics for the first time this year. The entire league is committed to doing everything possible to increase fan interest in the game. But can new fans be found?
Calgary has submitted an agenda item recommending compulsory numbers on game day jerseys and helmets for the media. Al Coates, can you speak to this?
As a league, we're always looking for exposure for our game.
Everyone at this table wants to believe new NHL fans can be found.
Get TV crews coming into the ranks in the morning and can't find out or know who the players are.
The year's first meeting between NHL head office and the league's 27 general managers takes place in November.
Identification on jerseys.
4 times a year we try to get the managers together to talk about the game. Rule changes, other issues affecting the operation of a club. It's a good opportunity for the managers to talk to each other, to talk to the league office. We want to make sure the product on the ice is as good as it can be at all times. And if we need to fine-tune what's going on in the game, either because of how the players are playing and the coaches are coaching, then we'll make the necessary changes.
I just don't think that it's being judged by the referees in every situation the same way. And I don't think you guys are doing it either. I think that the players are modifying their sweaters, their tie-downs, so they can take advantage of each other. I mean, I talked to the trainers about it.
When it comes to enhancing the game's appeal, the views of the league's general managers and those of NHL head office can differ.
It's okay for the guys to wear little short cuffs.
Brian Burke is a former pro hockey player, a Harvard-educated lawyer, and the commissioner's right-hand man. Any changes in the way the game gets played have to go through him.
You got a copy of the goddamn memo that went to the referees.
Yeah, but they don't go around and do anything about it. They get your memos and ignore it.
You just said to me, what did I do with the tape? You got an answer.
One guy that's been checked in this league, one guy's been checked, and there's only one guy that's done this because he had an old tie down on, there was nothing done. They know what the hell they're doing. Are you kidding me?
Want a break? Want a break? I'll check my stick here once we're done.
Looking for an advantage is just part of the game. Players have always tried to bend the rules as far as they can. They'll deliberately delay the game.
I don't want my legal one. I want the
food. They'll use special sticks.
That's my legal one. I don't want my legal one. I want my original one. He's got one stick and it's legal.
How about the hip check there on Keane? And he's 5 feet away from the puck.
They'll lobby for a power play.
He's defending himself.
By putting his hip out?
Well, if you're going to get run into, your first reaction would be to bend over, right? He didn't step into his line. He didn't move his feet.
Stuck his hip out. That's the first one.
But the player's greatest advantage may well lie off the ice, largely hidden from view.
It's bullshit by a billion times. Why do I say a billion? Because the payroll in 94, 95 was 440 million. It's now 700 and change, and it's going to go up. I think it's absolutely critical.
Bob Goodenough represents all 650 NHL players.
So you can make better decisions.
In his 7 years on the job, Goodenough has helped quadruple players' salaries.
See the trends with media. We have to understand and appreciate the sources for growth in the industry. Growth in the industry because we don't have a cap.
A labor lawyer by training, he enjoys a high approval rating among the men he represents.
The issue that would trigger that payment needs to be...
Any changes in the way the game gets played will affect his membership directly.
We can come up with a whole host of trigger points where if a player does this, that, or the other thing, or a team does this, that, or the other thing, you follow me?
Schedule.
And you can, in essence.
Guys come up to me and say, you know, this is our fifth game in 7 nights on a tough road trip. You know, what moron did the schedule? And since I'm one of the morons that does the schedule, I want to explain.
Each fall, Brian Burke and Bob Goodenough make a point of visiting every team in the league separately.
You only go through this career once.
So they can get their respective messages across.
You can't afford to be making mistakes. We want to hear
but
from
this
you
year is the NHL's Olympic year.
More responsibility.
Burke tells the players it's a golden opportunity to promote the game.
That's it for tonight, guys. Goodenough agrees. And right here,
Be a Boy Scout.
But it's early in the season. There's still plenty of time for things to go wrong.
We have the greatest product in the world. We've taken it to a new level in terms of exposure, but it requires the help of the players to do commercials, to go on TV shows, to do interviews. We're going to keep asking you. We need your help to make the game even bigger.
Brought to you by Ford. For now, forever.
This season, hockey fans can expect to see more of the NHL's marquee players than ever before. Because of the Olympics, the league is counting on players like Philadelphia's Eric Lindros to be ambassadors of the game. Lindros is in New York today to help promote the NHL's first ever appearance at the Winter Games.
That's really good. We appreciate you coming out to do this.
Glad to snow too much.
Wayne Gretzky is the great one. Lindros has been the next one for 6 years now. At 25, he is still growing comfortable with the role.
Now, are you ready to go?
Sure.
Great. You just follow me?
Got a question.
6 feet four, 230 pounds, Lindros is a skilled player who rarely shies away from the rough stuff. In many ways, he embodies one of the game's biggest image problems.
What, to give to Dave?
Is NHL hockey about athleticism or brute force? Olympics or no Olympics, new fans want to know. So does David Letterman.
Is hockey, have they done anything about the violence? Is it still where it ought to be?
Why are you talking about this violence?
Not me. You didn't hear it from me. It's part of the game, isn't it?
It's grown men playing at a high tempo, and it's very spirited.
But but there are guys in the league who just like to do that, aren't there? Who just like to drop the sticks, drop the gloves, and go nuts for a couple of minutes.
Jeez, we're getting a bad rap here in the league. No, there's, yeah. You're right. I can't lie.
In most sports, fighting means an automatic ejection. Not in NHL hockey. Some feel fighting has no place in the game. Others feel it's part of the game's appeal.
That's why you wear a mask, huh? Keep wearing that mask.
Hey, Jay,
keep wearing that mask.
Jay, let go.
Keep wearing that mask.
Jay,
chicken shit. Always wants a chicken shit, always a chicken shit.
But is it really what new fans want to see? And what do they want to see in Nashville?
This is the world's greatest game. It is the world's greatest sporting event. We have grace. We have flow.
Days before the All-Star break, season ticket sales have stalled at less than 6,000.
It's the fastest game played without an engine.
Team owner Craig Leopold is worried.
You like in a sport,
Brian Burke is here to get the Nashville media excited about the game.
We got people moving at speeds of 30 miles an hour in a league where hitting is not only tolerated but encouraged and is a vital part of our game. And they have to do it on a piece of steel that's an eighth of an inch wide. Other athletes don't have to get stitches as often as our guys do, or have dental injuries like our guys do, or get separated shoulders like our guys do.
We want to have our training camp right here in the arena so that we can get rid of all of the bugs.
Nashville's new state-of-the-art arena cost $144.5 million U.S.
Our thoughts right now are to make it open.
Burke feels it's money well spent.
I got to decide where I'm going to sit for the games now. Where
the NHL has little trouble getting people out to the game.
When we're winning, where would you sit?
Its popularity problems lie elsewhere.
We play to the highest percent capacity of any pro sport. Our television ratings have lagged far behind the other sport. We have to do something different. We have to get more people watching and get more interest. You might not like the Fox puck, but the competition is greater than it's ever been. And so the salesmanship and the marketing effort has to be greater than it's ever been. And I think we've done a nice job in that.
It starts off at about 35 miles an hour at white streak, and then at about 45 it turns to light blue.
and at 60 it turns to red, and then at about 65 or 70 miles an hour, speed bucks will come up and tell you the actual speed of the puck. And certainly not necessarily.
Canadian fans can follow the puck on TV.
Cities, but
lately, even in Canada, good ratings have been hard to come by.
Couple of things. Alan Abel is now starting to work on Paul Kariya.
The CBC's Hockey Night in Canada is a national institution.
The other thing is Bob Goodnow will be here on Saturday.
It's been on the air since 1952. This season has brought some bad news. TV viewership is down.
You know, I rationalize.
But there's been some good news, too. The CBC just signed a new broadcast agreement with the NHL and an aggressive new sponsorship package with Labatt's for the next 4 years.
What we've got to talk about is connecting emotionally with people, with TV viewers, with hockey players, with hockey viewers, with beer drinkers, and then turn it over and say, you guys go away and do your thing.
Representatives from Labatt's NHL head office and the CBC meet to discuss how they can win back old fans and capture the attention of new ones.
Very successfully done. They've turned Saturday night into a Canadian icon. So if we can turn around and turn Saturday night into something new and fresh through the broadcast, through the property, we believe we'll benefit by selling more beer. It's pretty simple.
I think Wayne, in his, if he has his final year, is a, you know, something to really follow through. I think Kariya is, and Patrick, and I think Yzerman is another piece of the equation. Canadian guys and Canadian stars. And I just think we have to think that through a little more.
What we're facing, you know, as a broadcaster, what we're facing is there's hockey now 6 nights a week, sometimes 7. So what the hell makes Saturday night so special? Other than the fact it's Saturday night, and it kind of brings me to promotion. When I first came in, I went to our PR people and I said, you know, we really don't do much on hockey night. And the answer back was, well, but everybody knows it's there. I said, well, then why does Coke advertise? Everybody knows Coke exists. Why do they advertise then? It's all about staying in the face. And we have not done a particularly good job at that, I don't think. You know, it just boggles the mind that we have a franchise called Hockey Night and you can't buy a shirt or a mug or even a pen that says it.
The Mighty Ducks of Anaheim are owned by Disney. They were among the first to reach out to new fans in bold new ways. The rest of the league has followed suit. Foster Hewitt might not recognize it. But in the late 1990s, this is NHL hockey. Hockey writers around the league can understand the NHL's need to sell itself, but it's not their job to buy in.
We all understand how the game is played now. There's a constant battle between the league office, which is selling an image, and the media, which seems to be resisting the sale. Certainly the written media doesn't view the game the same way the NHL administration would like us to view the game. And part of any general manager's job now, part of any coach's job now, and part of any agent's job, obviously, is to try and have as much positive impact as he can on a writer or on a TV guy.
They, along with others, were all saddened and probably disappointed that Mark wasn't coming back. I think we all believe that no one person is bigger than the whole organization.
When New York Rangers GM Neil Smith lost Mark Messier to Vancouver this past summer, Smith knew many New York fans would be upset. In all his subsequent public statements, Smith has tried to make amends.
If you don't want them back, because, quite frankly, we were hoping he would take it. Up to Alex, holy jeez!
Few in the hockey world credit Neil Smith's version of the story. When the Rangers made Messier a low-ball offer, they were reportedly delighted when the six-time Stanley Cup winner left town.
Scores! On the line change, Rangers got caught.
But when Messier returns to Madison Square Garden for the first time and scores a game-clinching goal, how Ranger front office feels is anybody's guess. For the hockey writers involved, the story is open to different interpretations.
He comes back here, they forget that they lose in the playoffs the last 3 years. They forget that he walks out for more money. They forget everything. And he's still Mark Messier, the hero, the guy who won the cup in 94.
To frame Messier as an individual who left for the money was simply a PR spin. And both sides tried to use the media as much as they could. They were wrong in not only not signing him, but they were wrong in the way they handled it. And we can't take an apple and say that it's an orange. I mean, what we're representing is what's going on in the National Hockey League. And I think we are the last line of defense for the fans.
Journalists are paid to report what they see, hear, and sometimes conclude. They are not paid to handle public relations.
Forget about it.
In the sports world generally, and in hockey more and more, the public's perception of how well a team or a player is doing can be directly tied to what sports writers have to say. In recent years, a growing number of NHL teams have taken steps to ensure that their players think carefully before they speak.
The media will absolutely make your business better. There was a day when you, probably when you started out playing hockey, when that's all you had to do, was just play hockey. But now, you know what? You're in the business of hockey. Even if it's the team that's hockey or you personally.
Andrea Kirby is a former sportscaster.
You have to learn.
She has coached 2,000 athletes on how to build great relationships with the media, how to control an interview, avoid controversy, and communicate with fans. Today, Kirby is working with the Philadelphia Flyers.
And if you could buy the whole page for a story on this team, it'd be worth $91,000 advertising dollars. You can't buy it. They're not going to do that. But that guy has the job of giving that to you for free every single day. So you want to make sure that you take advantage of it.
There are some people, Andrea Kirby doesn't have to coach.
That attract sponsorships and endorsements.
Chances are, even if you're a new hockey fan, you've heard of him. Most goals, most assists, most just about everything. Wayne Gretzky holds or shares more than 60 NHL records.
Effectively. And then you next, if that's okay. And then what will happen, Ron will...
This season has brought one on or more.
And then we will go into a more general Q&A, at which point...
The greatest hockey player of all time. Do you ever sort of... give your head a shake and say, I can't believe it's me.
I feel extremely honored, but I'm in a lot of ways a little bit embarrassed also. There's so many great players in our game, so many great people, what they've done to help sell hockey. So this is not etched in stone.
Arguably the NHL's biggest international celebrity, Wayne Gretzky has been one of the league's best assets for 20 years.
I said when I saw him in New York, the only thing that we didn't have, I asked him about it, was a white, plain white dress shirt.
Okay.
It's a Gretzky trademark.
No, but you know what I mean? Because you can wear a white dress shirt with everything. Just
jeans,
a plain white crisp dress shirt, you know what I mean?
For 20 years, Gretzky's achievements on the ice and his demeanor off it have put him in a position to sell a lot of things, not just hockey.
It's actually straighter than this, but we wanted it to look like a cloth label.
Yeah, I just did this in the computer.
This fall, it's clothes for the Bay.
So how do you feel about this whole fashion business?
I love fashion. Generally speaking, most men don't have as good a grasp on it as women do, you know? And basic colors, easier colors to work with each other seem to flow better and easier for men. And I think these colors, you know, will match and work for all men in the sense that Canadians won't be embarrassed to wear those colors. You know, the Browns have made a huge comeback and same thing, they dress nicely brown, you know. Again, you know.
A nice happy ground between casual and semi-elegant, you know.
Wayne Gretzky has paved the way for the NHL and many of the players in it.
I met him. We chatted, and I realized that they're really, Theron Fleury is the Rocky Balboa of hockey. And that's a wonderful story.
Everywhere fans turn, they see another new facet of the game. For players and corporations alike, the commercial spin-offs of NHL hockey are now worth hundreds of millions of dollars a year.
I had my goals against average ruined by Jeremy Roenick. I am here because of Jeremy Roenick. I'm working this corner now.
Ready? Roll camera.
Camera's rolling.
Ready and action.
8, 7, 6, 5, 4.
What I encourage are two things. We're going to be doing two different looks. One where you guys are looking bold and bad and big, and this huge 30-foot crane is sort of swooping in. You guys don't even have to do anything. When the camera comes along, you just look into the camera, do whatever. It doesn't even matter.
Beautiful. All with the stick, Don. There we go. Ready? 1, 2, 3. There's your scepter. Beautiful. That's very regal. Hold on.
Thank you.
The NHL has achieved mainstream professional sports status in the United States. Now, when an American team wins the Stanley Cup, it means a visit to the White House.
All around Canada and the U.S. and actually Russia and Sweden, and we even got a couple Americans on the team. So.
A reception at the White House, a new team in Nashville, a first ever appearance at the Olympic Games. For the NHL, this season really couldn't be going much better.
Thank you. Give them a hand, folks.
Then suddenly, everything changes.
And I've said before, the game sucks. I mean, I wouldn't pay to come watch. It's just, it's boring. And the whole style of the game is terrible. I mean, there's no flow to any game at all. It's, you know, as soon as a team gets going, you just ice it or throw it out of the building. Something's got to be done with our game.
Well, what would you do to change it?
I don't know. That's not up to me, but they've got to do something.
You know the feeling. Some say it's just a game. But you breathe life into it. Anger, joy, admiration. It's how it makes you feel. It's not about the contracts, the crowds, or the glory. It's about staring fear in the eye and not giving in. Playing past the pain and going for it all. You make it what it is and what it will become. Strength, pride, courage. It's more than just a game. It's who we are. It's who we will be. It can unite a nation and define a country. It's our game, and nobody can take that away. It's tradition. Keep it alive. The one and only Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
You have a camera or what? Pittsburgh Penguins star Mario Lemieux complained about the game throughout his career. Hockey writers have been saying there is something wrong with the game for years.
You know, 5 years left,
Bert. But this season, when Brett Hull makes his comments, suddenly it's front page news.
I spoke to Brett Hull yesterday myself, and Brett told me that he regretted the comment. He attributed
the league's commissioner is forced to make a public statement.
To brainlock, once in a while, Brett gets quoted as saying things that people find outrageous, such as we should boycott the Olympics and a whole host of other things. And in reflection, I don't think he meant those comments. At least that's what he said to me.
Just days later, behind closed doors at the next GM meeting, the question of what to do about Brett Hull's statement tops the agenda.
And my point is, and I'm using this as an example, both for you and for all the managers, it's important that we understand the type of damage that this type of statement can cause.
We're out there trying to sell tickets. We're out there trying to make sure our ratings are strong enough. I mean, we've got
Gary Bettman is one of the game's biggest boosters.
Real problem in terms of the perception.
Like many of the GMs present, it displeases him no end to have to defend it.
I mean, we're trying to sell this game. I don't understand how we can let our players do what they do to our game. They make all the money.
I think it infuriates them. It's very rare athletes in any sport say negative things about their game, because in the final analysis, it's a very good living, and all of us are lucky to be able to earn a living being associated with such a great game.
Let's put it all in the proper balance. I hear what Glenn's saying and everything else. No one condones it and is happy for what happened, but we've got to go forward and we have to deal with the issue. And that's what
if the league's image has been tarnished, it's up to the men in this room to repair it. But first, they must address Hull's statements. Is there any merit in what the St. Louis Blues forward has said?
You saw it and you didn't let it go?
No, I didn't see the fight.
Oh, you didn't see it?
No, I see a fight.
You're standing right beside it.
Guys, okay.
Defense has once again overshadowed offense this year in the NHL.
High sticks and the blue guy played it when it came down. The goaltender, look it out like that. No, it's a goal.
Players are frustrated playing the game.
I played the puck and I
waited. Outside! Outside!
Brett Hull may have drawn attention to this problem, but he did not create it. What did? Before the NHL's top executives can fix things, they must first agree on what is wrong. Could it be the officiating?
I just think that more penalties should be called. The game would be better. Scoring would go up. I don't think that many of us during our 82 games are very happy at the end of the game with the officiating.
I disagree more, you know.
But that's fine because you're not a GM.
I know I'm not a GM, but I felt the same way when I was a GM. I felt we lost a lot of nights. I didn't think the ref f***ed us when we lost.
Well, they're good, but let me. I miscommunicated if that's what you heard, because I didn't mean that they're not good. The officials are good, but at the way they're calling the game under our instructions, I'm mad. That's what I'm trying to communicate.
Is it possible that the NHL's current problems have at least in part been created by expansion? 5 new teams have been added to the NHL in the 1990s. Nashville, if successful, will be the 6th. More than 100 new players in the league, many with varying levels of skill. Is there no other way for an average player to successfully defend against a star player who possesses speed and finesse?
There's probably one guy, two guys on each team who have got the skill and the athletic ability and the strength to score a goal. And are we allowing the best players to be brought down to a level of mediocrity by the really unskilled guys? And maybe more importantly, are we totally eliminating the opportunity for a guy who's not a great player to score?
You know, there are a lot of games where the puck carrier, particularly some of our most skilled players, you know, the amount of tackling and slashing and holding and grabbing you see. And is that okay? Or should we be looking at that as well in terms of the standard that we're giving the officials? I mean, do we think we're letting the puck carrier take too much abuse?
I don't think so at all. I think that's our new age players who can't take a hit.
Okay.
And we haven't been anywhere near as physical in this league in terms of hitting. And all I hear is from the big players, oh my God, they're hooking me, they're holding me. Shoot the puck. Work hard. Spoiled.
This isn't passing a new rule. Are we calling this one right? How much physical abuse? What's the standard? And if the standard's the one we've got and everybody's in agreement, that's fine. But if we're not calling it tight enough in terms of protecting the puck carrier, let's discuss it.
You're letting the obstruction get out of hand again. That's all. If you, it's a lot easier for a skilled player to play if the guy who goes to pass to isn't being knocked on his ass.
You can't be checking people who don't have the puck. The puck is the game. And we get away from that. We forget all about the puck. There's 6 or 7 players on the ice in each shift who could care less if the puck's out there.
I believe that one of the areas we should revisit is our instruction to the officials to not calling any marginal calls. I think when we told that to the officials, what basically happened is we moved the threshold of what's being accepted, and from that point, they just put the whistle away.
In my opinion, other than the obstruction that's going on, the referee's better now than it's been in 10 years. Way better. But we get in a group like this, and pretty soon one guy's got an idea that initiates a thought in someone else's mind, and we all think we got to call more penalties. Let's get more penalties in the game. Let's get more power plays. Let's get more 5-on-3s. I mean, it's crazy. It's a great game. Fix up the obstruction. Let the players play a little bit. You know, you say they shouldn't hook the guy with the puck too much. Well, a little resistance towards a guy scoring isn't too bad either. Let's not make it so damn easy that just because a guy's got skill, he's going to walk through the whole team like they do with kids hockey. It's men playing hockey. That's what we want to see.
we're discussing what the standard is. In my opinion, the standard that was given...
The Olympics are coming up.
...was good. We have moved away from it.
TV ratings are down. This GM meeting could be historic.
Even in the last week, I can see a difference.
The media are sticking around. But at the end of day one, there's still no word. Does the game's obstruction problems call for rule changes or stricter enforcement? The GMs take some time to get reacquainted with the rules they themselves implemented just 3 years ago. The consensus seems to be that there's nothing wrong with the rules. It's just the way they're being enforced. Head referee Brian Lewis is asked to respond to the charges.
When this thing was implemented with all its good intentions, the standard was extremely high. The standard from where we started the obstruction rules to where it is today, I don't believe, is the same.
I can guarantee it is not.
Statistically, we're not bad, but game by game, when we break them down and analyze them as you people do, we have to sit there and say we're not pleased.
Why do we get away from that stuff? The attitude of the referees is all of a sudden shift and say, yeah, you can go and take this guy out now, it's legal. And I don't understand where it gets changed. Who changes it?
I think we're remiss just to point the finger at the official and say, you're not, when in fact a lot of it is a coaching tactic, and players are getting cuter. And that's why I say it's a tough one for all of us to accept, because normally it's not one that we're all looking for.
I mean, the rules are pretty good, aren't they? And I think the changes we made were pretty good, but we're somehow getting away from enforcing them. And what I wanted to suggest, and I've heard some of you guys say, that maybe it is time to think about two officials and one linesman.
Let's assume we thought going to two referees was a great idea. There are two issues. One is, we've got to get through the rest of the season. And two, I think we've got to get a standard first. You know, I'm increasingly of the view that it may be impossible for one guy to call this game.
Brian, from your perspective, sitting in the referee situation, is it the intimidation from the players? Is it the intimidation from the coach? Is it the directions that we keep giving that are confusing, that they don't know where they are? What would you pinpoint as to why it isn't where it was?
At almost at every turn, whether it be a team person, whether it be a hockey player, that's fine and dandy at the meeting, fine and dandy at training camp, and from that point on, the direction seemed to go, or the acceptance level seemed to go down. This penalty last night, I'm standing there thinking, geez, that's a good obstruction call. Somebody's beating on the door where I'm sitting and saying, that's horseshit. How in the hell can he call that? My immediate reaction is, that's what 25 people wanted, excluding you. We got to get the 26th guy to buy into it, that it's a good rule for the good of the game.
Harry, I took care of your team, Harry. It's all right. I charge normally, but...
No metal sticks on my team.
You wear that, you got to have your damn
Yeah, start to score. Yeah, you while you
want. I remember that.
Fans may not realize it. They may not even appreciate it. But one of the unique aspects of NHL hockey, when compared to other major professional team sports, is that the NHL is mostly run by men who can still play the game. At Brian Burke's suggestion, the GMs have held an annual shinny game each of the past 3 years. Maybe it helps remind them why they care so much about the game.
We have the 27 best people guiding our rule changes and guiding our game. These are people that love the game, that grew up with the game, that have passion for the game, and have great knowledge of the game. So I think I'm very content about the future of the league in terms of how hockey is played because of our managers.
You sit this ship, Bert.
You sit this ship. It's like I play it again.
I think it's a great game, and if we start meddling around too much of the rules, we're gonna ruin it. We can tinker a little bit with the rules, but we better be careful that we don't really do too many huge changes that really affect the flow of the game. It's guys like me, guys that are in the manager position, that are thinking of the welfare of the game, that have to be strong and make sure that we don't let too many changes happen to it. But some modifications may be the right thing to do.
It's fun to play. They all know it.
He's still the most valuable cup.
Now, if they could only make it more fun to watch.
There are three things that we're going to work on from a league standpoint. One is we're going to get a better definition of goalie equipment and make sure that it's purely protective and not defensive. And
it may have taken 36 hours of serious debate, but in the end, NHL head office and the league's GMs may have made a little history here in Phoenix.
Zero tolerance on hands.
They've not only made five major rule change recommendations, they've shown an unprecedented level of cooperation, all in the hope of doing what is best for the game.
I really want to thank everybody in this room for the discussion for the last day and a half. We got some work to do, but I think this will put us on the right track. And this was probably the most intensive day and a half of discussion on the game that I can remember this group having, and we really appreciate it.
Yeah, just a quick question, Gary. What is the consensus on outside comment?
The outside comment on this, the list of things that I articulated yesterday and today are the things that I'm going to describe to the media. The fundamental point here is these are all fine-tuning. We're not necessarily doing any of these. We're testing, we're looking, but the bottom line being, this group, to a man, likes the game and doesn't think we're falling off the face of the earth.
I think that the feeling was that goals are down, but the play is basically fine, and that there's nothing wrong with the game without some tinkering.
The league's top decision makers have just spent a day and a half openly acknowledging and addressing the game's problems in private.
At the same time, maybe make some
now they must face the media.
That go to enhance the rules that already are.
But will the media and the fans necessarily be convinced?
But the sense in the room was that we have a good game. We have a great game. That doesn't mean we can't improve it. But nothing is needed that's too radical, because the sense in there is that this game doesn't need radical solutions. It needs to be worked with and fine-tuned.
If all goes well, 1998's prospective season ticket holder and his family can look forward to seeing a more exciting, offensively-minded brand of NHL hockey around the league. Will that be enough to satisfy the new fans in Nashville, Tennessee?
They said we were too small, and we proved wrong.
The answer is yes.
We are now a hockey city.
The Nashville Predators will play their first NHL game against the Florida Panthers on October 10th, just as planned.
We must have a heightened
awareness. All that remains now is for everyone else in the league to make good on their promises.
The stick between the legs, as Brian said, is not a penalty. The defenseman in front of the net who puts the stick between his legs is not a penalty, nor is it, we have to be alert to the guy who would be doing this, the attacker skate in and allow the stick to come between his legs. But then if the guy in front of the net says, whoa, I want to go over here and forecheck, and the guy takes him and spins him around, that becomes a penalty.
The whole point of it is to control the flow of the game, and it's going to be phased in. It's going to be phased in, but the first phase-in point is going to be following the Olympics. It's going to start after the Olympics slowly, but then it's going to build, and then next summer and next fall, it's going to come in full-blown. So when they were giving you the gears, I said, hey, now wait a second. I said, Holy's done a lot for the game. In fact, tonight he's going to the Clancy Banquet. It was great doing it. Perfect time. That's just cool.
Just, Brian, are you worried about losing the essential flavor of the game somehow with all this experimenting?
Well, what I've said all along is I think it's very important that we go very slowly on this. I think the fact that scoring's down is easily explained. And now, can we solve that problem without, as you mentioned, affecting the essential integrity of the game? We have to find a way to do that. And if we can't, then we shouldn't make the changes.
The season that began so full of promise may have hit a snag halfway through. But the NHL's key decision makers feel things have been sorted out. Publicly, they've all said as much. Can they execute in the coming year? Hockey fans in Nashville and other cities around the league will just have to wait and hope.
Competitive hockey tournament.
And we go to Nagano, represent.
representing this country with pride.
The problem for me with the shootout is that it's an artificial contest.
You know, we didn't have success this time. It had nothing to do with the players.
It was almost like, you know, someone close or a family member had died.
The reaction internationally has been that this is fabulous. The Olympics were great, and they want us to do it again.
Part 3 of The New Ice Age, tomorrow at 9 on CBC.
I do it because my brother told me I couldn't.
I do it for my son, like my dad did for me.
I do it because I want to play in the big leagues.
I do it for fair play and sportsmanship.
I do it because I love the game.
Live the dream. The one and only Hockey Night in Canada on CBC. A special presentation of CBC Sports.
Did we get a little pop in our licensing here? The answer is probably yes. Did we get a little pop with our sponsors? But this wasn't about the money. This was about exposure.
You only go through this career once, so you can't afford to screw up. You can't afford to be making mistakes.
We're going to keep growing the game and making it bigger and better. And as the money grows here, don't change.
I want to be in a position to average out 1-5.
Jesus Christ.
You're fighting for a job here, and unless we see you be more assertive, you're going to Kentucky Friday morning.
Why, Finch? Why? You got no chance to get the puck anyways.
Maybe it is time to think about two officials and one linesman.
Should have a Canadian division.
That's right.
Can write a check for about $2 million,
and that'll do it.
If we continue to grow, then our shot in the barrel will come also.
He likes to say he oversees the greatest game on earth. All he has to do is sell it. Sell it, Gary Bettman does. On the job for less than 6 years, the NHL commissioner will have helped the league expand to 30 teams by the year 2000. The new teams have names like the Predators, the Thrashers, and the Wild. The new team owners tend to be flamboyant and free with their money. There are more sponsors. The big American TV deal is on its way. If the NHL feels bigger these days, it's largely thanks to Gary Bettman.
There's only so much you can do with the space anyway.
This year, he intends to make it bigger still with something he calls internationalization.
Internationalization became the theme because once we decided we were going to the Olympics and shutting down for 17 days, we had no choice.
Hockey fans have often argued that pro hockey players should be part of the Olympic Games. This year, Gary Bettman has finally made it happen. The Winter Olympics in Nagano will bring the NHL game to the world stage. The greatest players from the greatest league putting on the greatest hockey show the world has ever seen. As the 1997-98 season gets underway, that's the plan. The NHL's international project begins to take shape right at the start of the season. The Vancouver Canucks and the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim will play their first two games of the season 8,000 kilometers away from home in Tokyo, Japan.
This was a great opportunity for us who love this game to share the NHL game because we want Japan and other countries to start playing this great game.
The league would also like someone else to pay for the Tokyo Games. Japanese electronics giant Dentsu becomes the major sponsor.
Doing business in Japan
generally meaning promoting an event, requires you to have a local partner, and they also absorb the financial risk.
For the NHL, these two games in Japan are an Olympic trial run, an historic chance to sell the NHL game, and some NHL licensed merchandise.
If merchandising only works with exposure, we're doing more business. It's not the leading licensed brand in Japan right now, but it's growing and we're doing it one step at a time.
Tickets cost $400 a piece. They sell out in 3 hours. Ample evidence that overseas interest in the NHL game is growing.
Now this is a Friday afternoon. These people have been online for a couple of hours already. Some people, we were told, actually stayed through the night as the players come out here incredibly orderly, incredibly well-behaved, and they just can't wait to get their favorite players' autographs.
I like Dallas Stars and Ducks, Mighty Ducks. I love NHL.
104 years old, 36 inches high, 35 pounds. And it's got about almost 2,000 names on it now. But North Americans want to play for it, and now the world wants to play for it, which is great.
Opening the NHL season in Japan has its drawbacks. Staging an NHL game is hard enough under the best of circumstances.
Who is the timekeeper?
It's hard to still in Japanese.
No, you're doing a good job. Okay, so basically he gets it from that gentleman then,
yeah.
Right? Okay, that's fine.
Okay, this is an Anaheim goal from number 31.
Number 31.
Yep, 31, unassisted. Don't go there yet, please. Go back. Okay. This is number 31, unassisted. Okay.
Playing an NHL game is hard enough anywhere.
We're going to have it perfect.
Playing it halfway around the world.
You want to go hard to the outside with the puck. If you can't take that D-man deep, you want to make
sure. For the game of hockey and spreading the word of the NHL, it's an important game to happen here. But our team can't get caught up in that. Our players can't get caught up in that. We're here to win a hockey game. That's all there is to it. And we happen to be playing on a rink in Tokyo, and that hopefully is not going to matter.
The expectations.
Vancouver's new captain, Mark Messier, is here. The big disappointment is that Paul Kariya is not. The one NHL superstar of Japanese descent is back home, still unsigned by the Mighty Ducks.
They're dropping the puck for the first time, away from North America, right here in Tokyo.
Trevor on the fly. Live in Yoyogi Arena and back home in Canada on the CBC. The games are well received.
Potentially a goal-saving defensive play right there.
Mess on the fly.
When Gary Bettman looks forward to the Winter Olympics in Nagano, he is pleased.
While it wasn't a way to make a lot of money, it was an attempt at little or no cost to the league and the teams to get into the marketplace and get exposure and get people focused on NHL hockey, so we just weren't one of the other Olympic sports starting up in February. We got a very good, solid reception and reaction.
The team split the series, but they arrive home jet-lagged. But Vancouver's Pat Quinn can see the upside.
I think the mandate of Bettman and of course in partnership with the Players Association, they want to look to international fields to develop our business, both from the standpoint of building revenues, but also to the standpoint of building interest in playing the game. Because as we grow, we're going to have more countries playing hockey to supply the players we need to play in the National Hockey League.
The Olympics are still 2 months off, but already, Canada's got Nagano fever.
There's almost a frenzy in our country to find out what the list is. And the fans, everywhere you go, there's pools and all of that. And that's just great to see that hockey means so much to this country.
it's not quite the same name in the video.
The most famous Canadian team of all time was Bob Clark's team, the one that defeated the Russians in 1972. Tonight, when this year's Olympic hockey team selections are telecast nationwide, the final say belongs to Bob Clark.
Where we've just seen this thing build in all week, and tonight at 6:30 when the list is unveiled, it's going to be as big an announcement as ever been done in this country in sport. And we've probably got 30 or 40 that really felt that they had a shot at this team.
30 or 40 players for a 23-man roster? For the team's managers, that's a good thing. For the players, it's just the opposite.
It was the best-kept secret in Canada, for sure. You know, it was just like anybody else. You know, we all had to watch it on TV. And so that was a bit nerve-wracking.
What's the mood like in Ottawa? There's Scott Russell. Scott?
Oh, what's the mood like, Ron? A tremendous feeling of anticipation, nervousness, call it what you will, but it's wonderful to see amongst the professional hockey players.
From Campbell River, BC, to Campbell River, Colombie-Britannique, Rod Brindamour! From Oshawa, Ontario, the Oshawa, Ontario, Joe Newendine! From Mimico, Ontario, to Mimico, Ontario, Brendan Russell, Manitoba, the Russell of Manitoba, Tiron Fleury.
I just heard it.
Big name missing from Bob Clark's list. A six-time Stanley Cup winner, the spiritual leader of every team he has ever been on, has not been selected. Those who follow the NHL game want to know why.
And then we'll be straight to questions and answers.
Okay. Yep. We'll get through that quickly.
I guess with the opening remarks, I said the journalists are going to ask about why Lindros is going out of sea, and I'll just say that Lindros will be the captain and Sakic and Eisenman are the assistants.
Yeah.
And I might as well mention then that Paul Kariya is going to join the national team on Monday, the 1st of December.
Mm-hmm. Just curious of the decision on Mark Messier and how that the thought process went in excluding him from the team.
It wasn't our position to exclude anybody, Mike. We tried to put together what we felt would be the best team.
For Bob Clark, there has never been any doubt about who would lead Team Canada to Nagano. The Philadelphia Flyers have been built around Eric Lindros.
Lindros seems to be the young horse that Canada wants to ride now, and he's proving to be a terrific leader, and he's had the opportunity to play with all these great players. We think that that Lindros was the right choice.
As Flyers GM, Clark is currently in deep contract negotiations with his star center.
I think it was time that a new group of players from our country started taking some of the responsibility. Lindros could be a captain for the next Olympics and the one following that, too.
Great. And let's do one more with a smile and looking here. Great. Excellent. You're all finished.
More than a billion viewers watch the Atlanta Summer Games every day. Who knows how many will tune into Nagano? Nike comes on board early, buying the rights to design and manufacture Olympic hockey team jerseys.
Russia, you know, this pattern on the arm is taken from the basilica. You know, the color of the brick is the maroon from the basilica.
In the end, scores of corporate sponsors get involved. In the weeks leading up to Nagano, the NHL star players are everywhere.
I think it's every kid's dream to play in the Olympic Games. Nothing can compare to playing for your country. I've played for Canada before, but this is the Olympic Games. It'll be one of Canada's.
No matter who wins
Olympic
the gold medal in Nagano, Gary Bettman is confident that the NHL will come out on top.
Shh. The Russian team is next door.
When you have a sports league and you're competing with all the other forms of entertainment and all the other sports, you've got to do everything possible to build your brand.
You know what else would be great?
What?
If we spoke Russian.
The Olympic Games in Nagano собрали лучших из лучших.
This has been, over the last 5 or 6 years, a very difficult retail marketplace for all branded merchandise, licensed merchandise, especially for sport.
The way you have to hold this.
Having said that, over each of the last 5 years, we've had double-digit increases in our share, in our growth. We're still not as big as I think we need to be or we can be, but we're heading in the right direction.
Because I'm real photogenic, it shouldn't be too tough.
Well, I hope we all get a free truck out of this.
Chrysler Canada was the only automotive manufacturer that owned the Olympic rings. And therefore, having the professional hockey players from the NHL who were playing on the Olympic team meant that we could leverage both of those in our advertising support, not just to get exposure for Chrysler, but also to congratulate the athletes for what they did.
At the Winter Olympics in Nagano, Japan.
We were in every other TV network, just reminding people that, hey, Dodge is with them. Chrysler is with the athletes and they're supporting them.
For the National Hockey League, it's just a totally a win-win situation in a sense as, merchandising over there. And then secondly, as far as marketing and promoting our sport worldwide, I think in the end of the day that this will be a great situation for the whole game of hockey.
Well, that's good.
So you've been doing a lot of reading in bed?
Well, I've been doing a lot more.
And the crew that we've assembled here and met for the last few days, the nine guys, total 174 years of professional hockey experience.
Like the NHL players chosen for the Olympics, the NHL officials have been selected with great care. Kerry Fraser, Mark Fossett, and Bill McCreary are among the league's most respected referees in big game situations.
Fighting in excessive manners is a match penalty.
The Olympics are played under International Ice Hockey Federation rules. Officials will be expected to enforce stiff regulations on everything from fighting and obstruction to shootouts and the curve of a goaltender stick.
The goalie stick regarding the curvature, is that half inch like everybody else's?
Yeah. It's in metric.
Oh, baby.
Everything's metric. Everything in the rule book is metric.
Oh, no.
We're going to have a very, very exciting and competitive hockey tournament because the caliber of talent will be spread throughout the participating teams, and to have best on best at the world's biggest stage for sporting events, we think will be another step in the march for increased exposure, and so we're very excited about the opportunity. The international thematic carried through to the All-Star Game, we thought it would be kind of neat to have North America play the world. 70% of our fans thought it was terrific and were in favor of it. It made the All-Star Game even a little more fun than usual.
For this game to be successful, it's got to be competitive. And we're not talking about that it's going to be a lot of hitting or anything different like that. We know the type of players who play here. It's a high-octane game, and that's fine. But a 10 to 10
this
game,
year's All-Star Game isn't the usual East-West affair. It's the international showdown, North America against the world.
With the international flavor to this year, we started the season with games in Tokyo. We have North America versus the world here on this weekend. And then, of course, we're heading to Nagano shortly. Congratulations and good luck. Have fun this weekend, guys.
Now, question for you. After the first one,
everyone involved sees the game as an Olympic preview.
In the house, I would like to be able to do a quick interview with somebody from the winning relay while the one-on-one guys are being taken through the course and getting ready for that.
From my understanding, CBC was doing all interviews since it's in Canada, so it's taking a fee from you guys as opposed to taking a fee from ESPN in the States.
No, I understand.
Yeah. Okay. The game and the skills will be seen in over 160 countries. We have about 10 to 15 international crews here as we get ready for our big push to Nagano. ESPN is covering the skills on Saturday in the United States and in Canada, CBC and SRC. We have an MTV special. We have a Comedy Central special. And at the end of the day, we also have Power Week, which gets seen in another 160 countries. So there's a lot of great exposure for us as a sport. And this is our weekend to kind of shine and come out front.
Got to beat more smoke for the show.
People are given lots and lots of choices as to how to spend their leisure time and their leisure dollars.
You can go.
People want to be entertained. They want to go to arenas that have all the amenities. They want to feel good about the experience, particularly for newer and younger fans. That's important.
I like the idea. Who came up with the idea of the North America against Europe?
I'll answer that question after
the
game's over.
Yeah. I get your style. I like that style.
Even the players sense something special about this year's contest.
I think there's so many good European players that people don't have a chance to see them all, and in this type of format to really see their talent and really see them shine as a team.
3 weeks from now, they'll be facing off against each other in Japan.
Buy-sell trade upgrade.
A sellout crowd of 18,000 watches the game live. In Europe, a record 25 countries tune in. America wins the All-Star game, but the highlight of the All-Star weekend is the skills competition. Buffalo goalie Dominik Hasek was born and raised in the Czech Republic. He faces North America's five best shooters.
Hasek, because they really never know what he's going to do. Ryan Leach can't beat Dominik Hasek. Scott Niedermeyer, the next up to try and win it, then he shoots wide. Joe Sakic.
The All-Star game was well received. The game was fun. It was interesting. It was more competitive than usual. And the research tells us that the fans liked it.
Wayne Gretzky for the win, and Hasek stopped him. One left, and it's Theo Fleury, who's been dynamite in the past. Fleury in. Hasek stopped him. Hasek will win the goaltender's battle.
I wouldn't be surprised if we did it again.
Hasek has always been a great goaltender. This year, he's been unbelievable. The world team wins the shootout, but for the North Americans, they're still Nagano. In early February, the NHL's international campaign reaches its final destination.
Going into this tournament, this has all the credentials of being like 72 was. We actually watched the 72 series on the way over on the plane. We've never been to Olympic Games before, athletes, most of us.
Thank you very much.
People here haven't had an opportunity to see some of the best players in hockey be here, and everyone's excited about it. One of the things the NHL wanted to do for the game was to really showcase our sport. And without question, it's on center stage. We're going to get an opportunity to show how great this game is.
Interrupting the NHL's regular season for 17 days hasn't been easy, even for Gary Bettman.
There were a whole host of issues related to how the tournament was going to be played, what kind of travel, what the gateway cities were going to be, where the players were going to stay, how we were going to play the tournament, how long the season was going to shut down for, what kind of compression we were going to have, when we were going to begin the season, when we were going to end the season, and on and on and on. And it was made even more difficult by the fact that we were going to do this halfway around the world.
The question now is, will all the disruption be worth it? Will the players deliver? Will the league's long-term interests be served?
It was a good dry run if we decide we want to do it again in Salt Lake City. But this wasn't about the money. This was about exposure.
All signs are positive. Japanese reaction to the Canadian team overwhelms even veteran players like Theo Fleury.
I don't think any of us expected, you know, the reception that we got.
Canadians are very popular. People can identify with Canada, and the Japanese people, you know, as a nation, are pretty friendly and outgoing, and they've made it very easy for us to be in their country.
Everybody's very excited to be here. I think I can speak for all the team. I genuinely see great excitement in the dressing room, great excitement from the players, great anticipation for the games starting to begin. I think every one of our players to a man, every one of the coaches, every one of the management staff all understand that the tournament is one in which there is a great field.
Fleury is keeping a video diary of the trip. In the dressing room, he and the others find a collection of Canadian Olympic team sweaters dating back to the 1920s.
I'd like to wear that one.
A reminder of Canada's proud hockey history. In every player's locker, Bob Clark has left another motivational surprise. Pictures of the players before they became stars.
Even all the guys, just for guys, for about 2 minutes here. We're here with a purpose. We're here with a focus. And, you know, we're going to do whatever we can to make sure that we come up with the outcome that we want. I think that's the attitude that we want to have. Let's continue to have that. I think we really got to be smart about how we eat, how much we eat, because the weight is something you can really put on. This is going to be home for a long couple of weeks, guys, so let's make it good.
This ain't a bad roommate right here.
I thought it was excellent at the Village, you know. When you play major junior hockey, you know, you sleep on the floor of a bus for 4 years, so to stay in a Village like that, you know, is no problem.
The Canadians have decided not to go the dream team route. They may be millionaires, but for the next 2 weeks, they will live like all the other athletes at these games.
All right.
How you doing?
Good, how are you?
Yeah, this is it. I'm Dave's mom.
We're all excited, the attention that we're getting.
The commissioner is in Nagano too, holding press conferences and hoping for the best.
If this is successful, is it TV ratings? Is it if markets are opened up elsewhere? How do you determine if it works?
It's a variety of things. Part of it is the reaction. It's what kind of attention this got for our game, how big a building block it was, and part of that is how much you write about us, how many people actually get an opportunity to see the games on television, what the overall response is, how the players felt about it. In the final analysis, the players are the ones who have to play, and we understand that.
The competing teams have just 3 days to get used to being here. The team that makes the best adjustment will likely win the gold medal. For Team Canada, that means adjusting to the big ice.
To either this guy heading up in there or that guy coming in behind.
It's going to be an adjustment for all of us, the defense, the forwards, the different game as far as playing behind the net goes. There's obviously a lot more room, and it's an adjustment we're all going to have to make, both offensively and defensively.
Canada has size, speed, and superb puck control. No one can spot a weakness. Sweden has a strong team too. With 18 NHL players, many expect the defending Olympic champions to end up on the podium again this year. Russia has 22 NHL players, and in Vladimir Yurzhanov, a highly respected coach. The Czech Republic has one of the NHL's leading scorers, Jaromír Jágr, and in Dominik Hasek, the league's best goalie. But no one is expecting miracles. Half the players on the Czech roster don't play in the NHL. The Americans won the World Cup 2 years ago. They are expected to make it to the gold medal round.
You're worrying about concepts, getting guys to understand that in Europe it's an east-west game as much as it is north-south. We're 2 points of the compass in at home, and here you've used all four.
The Canada-US game is seen as a preview of the gold medal final. This worries Gary Bettman.
Too many people, particularly in the media, were willing to equate the performance of the U.S. team and the Canadian team with the success of the Endeavor. It's not quite fair, and it wasn't quite what we had bargained for going in.
Okay, now listen to me. We're going to have a really good game, and there's going to be no bullshit, all right? We'll play like men, you get treated like men.
Like Bettman, Brian Burke feels the media is getting carried away.
Someone asked me, wouldn't it be nice to have a gold medal game between Canada and the U.S.? And I said, whoa. I said, you had better look at these rosters before you talk like that. I said, the North American arrogance and ignorance shining through that question.
Well, that play like that was great. Should I do my best to try to make that save? Or if he's in the crease?
You make the save, all right? Both feet are in the crease like that. It's no goal, Patrick.
This was truly a great tournament. Nothing like this dream team stuff. This was a dream tournament.
The Olympics offer an exciting brand of offensive hockey North Americans seldom get to see. The big ice limits obstruction. Fighting is not permitted under international rules. The NHL has been thinking of tightening up its rules as well.
Before the Olympics, they had drawn up the plan for the obstruction rules. And they were going to enforce these rules post-Olympics. So I'm sure as they watched the game on a larger rink, they must have been thinking, it'll be interesting to see if our obstruction rules will work and can open the game up and maybe make the game a little bit more offensive, make it a little bit more entertaining, more like the game they were viewing in Nagano.
But the league's commissioner says he likes the NHL game.
U.S. is going to have a tough time.
I'm not a fan of the big ice, and people tend to confuse the big ice with no obstruction.
Guys, I only need one penalty. It's just one man only. Makes it easy.
The fact is, when you have your 125 best skilled, most skilled players playing, you're apt to see less obstruction.
Is he like the big ice or what, Primo?
I think our ice surface is preferable to big ice.
The third, this is over. So Canada handles the USA today in their big meeting by defeating the United States 4-1.
Brett Hull and his American teammates take the loss to Canada hard.
How devastating would it be if you guys don't medal?
We already asked that one. I don't know. Because I'm certainly not thinking that. Nobody's thinking that, I don't think. I hope not. Because if someone's thinking that, that's the only one guy it takes to...
Even like up there talking to Hull, he was talking about how, you know, after a couple of games, they still haven't worked out exactly what they want to do, and he was calling his teammates selfish and all that. We didn't come here not to win. We want to win as badly as anyone.
They were hoping that the fallout wasn't going to be as bad as it would be. The publicity they got out of it was almost all negative, and I think that they had hoped that while they wouldn't get the big bump that they're hoping for in Salt Lake in 2002, it didn't turn out that way. I mean, a lot of ways it went horribly wrong.
2 days later, after losing to the Czech Republic, U.S. team members go out on the town. Later that night, at the Athletes' Village, they break chairs and spray fire extinguishers about. Damage is only estimated at $3,000 U.S., but for Gary Bettman and the NHL, the cost is incalculable.
I think the NHL shocked. I think Gary Bettman was shocked how many reverberations there were from this, and particularly with the U.S. team.
This type of conduct, if it can be proven and established, can't be condoned.
I'm more disappointed that the players who were responsible just didn't come forward and say, whoops, we made a terrible mistake, we're sorry. The incident, you know, took on a bigger life because of that.
For the first time, Gary Bettman's international project is in trouble. America's NHL players are out of the games, but Canada's are still in. Now it's up to the Canadians to show the world the superiority of the North American NHL style of play. Canada needs to beat the Czech Republic to move on to the gold medal game.
Canada and the Czech Republic. Canada undefeated. Coming into the game, the Czech Republic, Harry, lost only once.
There's just one problem.
The Czechs are great realists.
mean, if you are a country the size of the Czech Republic, and if you've had the history of Central Europe, you've got to be released.
And the Canadians want to throw a lot of rubber.
The Czechs in the early 70s, they had one rival, the Soviet Union. How do we beat them? You allow the Soviets always to force the play. And then what you do is you try to get them to commit themselves, you intercept a pass, you break back 2-on-1, and you score occasionally and often enough to win. And you have as your backbone in the other end, good goaltending. And then you can win it. Well, you know, the Czechs really haven't changed in terms of their style of play.
Czechs played probably and used the ice better than any of the other European teams because they had 8 guys that have played that style all year long, have been untouched by the NHL. One of the things that Canada's always been successful at in international competition is putting together a series of 7 or 8 good shifts in a row that shifts the game, gets the other team back on their heels, and boom, we score. We just seem to have a couple of good shifts, never enough in a row, in succession, to really give the other team the impression, uh-oh, here comes Canada.
The shot, block, rebound. What a save by Hudson. Score!
With 63 seconds left in regulation time, Canada finally scores. After 10 minutes of overtime, it's still 1-1. Under international rules, tie games must now be decided by something that occurs regularly in international tournaments, but never in the NHL.
The problem for me with the shootout is that it's an artificial contest. It's a contest that bears no relationship to the rest of the game. It's penalty shots, and a goalie and a team will face maybe one, maybe two penalty shots in a whole season. It's exciting. I find it unfulfilling.
Whatever their merits or shortcomings, shootouts are unlikely to be seen in NHL games anytime soon.
I will sit as long as it takes to have that game be decided by the players who played the game to that point. I admit that it's exciting. There's no, you know, in hockey, there's no better challenge than the goaler against the shooter. It's the ultimate matchup. But for me, it's a little too contrived. If I was at that level with something that important to be decided for the rest of my life, I would be wondering, well, what if we had played the game to finish? I wonder what really would have happened if the players and the teams and the coaches decided the outcome rather than, you know, the shootout.
You know, with breakaways, when you have a 50-50 opportunity of scoring, you can't really second guess yourself and, you know, beat yourself up because you missed. It's just unfortunate that, you know, a game such as that, you know, played so well by both teams, had to end that one.
The Czechs score only one goal on Patrick Roy.
No!
Dominik Hasek takes care of the rest.
So it just shows that the game is healthy in a lot of places, and I think the fact we didn't win it, obviously, it bothers us. We would have loved to have won it. But the fact we didn't win it is not a bad thing. It's good for the game. I mean, it makes us a little hungrier for the next one. And it makes the Europeans very proud of their performance.
It was almost like, you know, someone close or a family member had died. The feeling you have, the empty feeling.
The next day, Canada loses the bronze medal game to Finland.
Whether you're a 7-year-old playing in a championship tournament game or a 37-year-old playing in a game like this, it's devastating. And you never get over it. You never learn to accept it. And each and every time, it's just very, very difficult to accept and understand.
It's like you let your country down and you let your teammates down. And it's a completely empty feeling. You just want to stick your head in the ground.
We've always put teams together fairly quickly and had some success, but you know, we didn't have success this time, and it had nothing to do with the players or anything, but if we don't learn from this and make the changes that are necessary to try and win the next time in Salt Lake City, then we'd be foolish.
The Canadian team had won a gold medal. They would have represented the model for every team after of how you prepare yourself for a tournament. Everything worked except they didn't score a goal in the first 60 minutes of the game against the Czech Republic. If they had, I suspect that they would have won a gold medal. And the legendary stories of how that team was put together, you know, would have followed. But it didn't happen.
The tough decision to sell the team.
May or may not be the last hurrah for the Quebec.
You should have a Canadian division.
Bring you guys up there. Come down here once a week.
We're just doing everything we can, twice as hard.
But we're paying almost 50% more than the American teams are.
I mean, the Oilers sell out every game, and they can't afford to be here. It's sad. Very sad.
Part 4 of The New Ice Age, tomorrow at 9 on CBC.
For the first time in over a decade, European teams sweep the Olympic medals. The Czech Republic, gold. Russia, silver. Finland, the bronze.
From my point of view, I think it's still a good outcome for the game. Disappointing for us in Canada and North America. But the NHL gained a lot of valuable exposure, and I think it was still pretty impressive hockey.
For Canada, no medal. Just a lot of soul searching. Many North American journalists see the medal result as an indictment of the NHL.
The NHL has always prided itself in being perceived as the best league in the world. And all of a sudden, the curtains were pulled back, and that wasn't true. You know, the king had no clothes. That there were other leagues. There were a bunch of fine Czech players who were better than the best NHL players on both Canadian and the U.S. teams. And I think it really exposed the NHL to a certain extent.
The commissioner takes some especially hard hits.
For Gary Bettman, this year couldn't have been worse. From the way people looked at the game, to the people who looked at his expansion plans, to a lot of things. And then came the Olympics. And for Bettman, this was the ultimate disaster, because as the guy who believes that style can overcome substance, that selling the game is what we didn't understand before, and marketing it, and then everybody would think it was wonderful. All of a sudden, that was thrown back in his face, because everything went wrong.
The aftermath of the U.S. experience in Nagano was a disaster for the league. But I felt all along that breaking and playing for the Olympics was a mistake to begin with. Because I think that what the league does by stopping its season for 2.5 weeks and using all of its energy to promote the Olympics is telling the fans that the regular season just isn't really important. That the season isn't important, but the Olympics are important. And then, you know what, the playoffs will come along later, and then, you know, that'll be important too.
Bettman sees it differently.
I think there was too much confusion between the endeavor of having this great Olympic tournament with the world's best players representing their countries and the performance of either the U.S. or the Canadian teams. I will say, and I don't think I'm going out on a limb by saying it, that had the U.S. team played the Canadian team in the gold medal game, there would have been scant criticism of the endeavor.
Despite the criticism, Gary Bettman feels the NHL's international campaign has been a success. The 1998-99 season opener will again take place in Tokyo. The format of next year's All-Star Game is yet to be determined, but it will again likely feature North America versus the world. The league's participation in the 2002 Olympics in Salt Lake City is still up in the air, but chances are the NHL will be there. For Gary Bettman, NHL hockey remains the greatest game on earth. His job is just to sell it.
The reaction internationally has been that this is fabulous, that the Olympics were great and they want us to do it again. All the federations, the television coverage, the exposure, the ratings throughout Europe and the rest of the world were phenomenal. it's a building process. You do it one step at a time, and it was a good first step.
Special presentation of CBC Sports.
So unless there's we find a way to share what's going on, unfortunately, hockey is a dead issue here in Canada, in small markets.
You only go through this career once, so you can't afford to screw up. You can't afford to be making mistakes.
We're going to keep growing the game and making it bigger and better. And as the money grows here, don't change.
I want to be in a position to average out 1-5.
Jesus Christ.
You're fighting for a job here, and unless we see you be more assertive, you're going to Kentucky Friday morning.
Why, Pinch? Why? You got no chance to get the puck anyways.
Maybe it is time to think about two officials and one lineman.
Should have a Canadian division.
You can write a check for about $10 million, and that'll do it.
If we continue to grow, then our shot in the barrel will come also.
Someone once said, it's more important to the nation than many of the political ideals we pretend to believe in. The House of Commons endorsed it anyway, as Canada's national game.
And the Canadians make the lead 1-0.
It's been called our winter ballet, the dance of life in a cold climate, the national drama, the national conversation, the one place where all the themes of Canadian life get played out. And now, it's in trouble. The Edmonton Oilers were one of the greatest hockey teams of all time.
Here it is, Wayne LeBoyne.
Led first by Wayne Gretzky, then by Mark Messier, the Oilers won the Stanley Cup 5 times in 7 years. Today's Oilers can play the game too. In the 97-98 season, they advance as far in the playoffs as any other Canadian team. They reach the second round before losing to the Dallas Stars in 5 games. But they spend most of the season in limbo. This year, team management's focus is not so much on winning or losing hockey games. It's on keeping the team in Edmonton. This year, the storied Edmonton Oilers go up for sale.
Let's go! You got the train from hell.
After 20 years as team owner, Peter Pocklington is $100 million in debt.
I've therefore made the tough decision to sell the team. I've done my best to keep the team here in the past. And I'll do my best to sell the team to people who will keep it here in the future. My first priority is to seek out local investors to step forward and take my place.
Within weeks, Texas millionaire Les Alexander offers Pocklington $82.5 million U.S. to buy the team and likely move it to Houston.
Yes, we do. We have a handshake agreement which is being papered over the weekend by our mutual lawyers, and hopefully it'll get done.
This is the third time in as many years that a Canadian NHL team seems headed for the States.
Money, the team was finally sold.
Save Argent! Save Argent!
Last time it was the Winnipeg Jets. The owner wanted a new rink. When he didn't get one, the team was sold to Phoenix in 1995 and renamed the Coyotes.
Hockey fans met again at Portage and Main in the largest public gathering since the World Wars.
May or may not be the last hurrah for the Quebec Nordiques in this building.
That same year, the Quebec Nordiques were sold to Colorado, renamed the Avalanche. The same players won the Stanley Cup the very next year.
I don't think anybody's going to blame us by not taking the engagement to lose that kind of money for many years to come with no hope.
We haven't received an offer from local
First,
bidders.
Winnipeg and Quebec get in trouble. Now, Pock Linton himself. The Texas multimillionaire is still interested, but local investors are staying away.
Welcome any offer from Edmonton to keep it here. If there are local buyers, show up.
The non-breakable thing.
One group of local investors has been trying to show up for months. Motivated by civic and national pride, Edmonton Oil and Gas executive Cal Nichols and his associates have been working hard to keep the Oilers in Edmonton. But they are running out of time. The sales deadline is Friday, March 13th, just 3 days away.
The facts are this. On the equity investment side, we are currently just under $50 million committed. We still need, as of now, approximately $10 million of additional equity. And I would like to ask anyone who is capable and interested in participating in our group to come forward as soon as possible, as our deadline is rapidly approaching.
Nichols has transformed his suburban Edmonton office into what he and his team call a war room.
Premier Klein phoned me at home last night and wanted to know what else he could do to further our cause to...
Their current money-raising scheme is to rename Northlands Coliseum Petroleum Place and have Alberta's major oil and gas companies sponsor the team.
And I told the Premier last night that another follow-up letter, fax from him would be helpful, and he also agreed to make a few personal phone calls and...
Doug McFarlane works with Nichols in oil and gas. Reg Berry is in broadcasting. Longtime friends, they are accomplished in their fields. But most observers don't give them much of a chance.
For these companies, I think it's important they participate in community building.
Right now, I think we've got about 2 million new and in new commitments.
The feeling is the Oilers will wind up south of the border.
2 million a year over 3 years.
Besides these? The reality is that there's not going to be an announcement tomorrow. Mm-hmm. And we're going to be Friday, late Friday at best, because the guys just...
It's a leap of faith.
It's too much leaps, too many leaps of faith here. And we got some irons in the fire that still may materialize that may get us closer to where we want to be. So,
if hockey is Canada's national game, and the Oilers are such a legendary team, how can this be? Why is it so hard to keep an NHL team in Canada?
It's easy to get through the world.
5,200 kilometers southeast of Edmonton, the NHL Board of Governors winter meetings take place at the Breakers Luxury Resort Hotel. All 26 NHL team owners or their designates attend. The focus of today's session is another Canadian team. The board will decide whether to allow the Toronto Maple Leafs to move back into the Eastern Conference. The move would reignite the Leafs' traditional rivalry with the Montreal Canadiens and permit those games to be broadcast on Eastern primetime TV. The motion mostly affects the struggling small market Canadian teams, Edmonton and Calgary, who fear losing their popular and profitable games against the Leafs.
It's big for us. I mean, it's a big issue for Calgary and Edmonton and Vancouver. For us, I think also it's a nationalistic issue. It's just not money. It's keeping Canada whole and the rivalries going. And
but do you think you have the votes here? Or is that...
No idea.
Eh?
No idea.
Is it very close?
Whenever you need three quarters, it's always close.
The only one that care are the Canadians, the Canadian teams. The rest of us don't care.
Which way are you going to vote?
I don't care where they go. It doesn't make any difference to us.
I care.
I know you do. You're a Canadian team, and they should be playing. You should have a Canadian division.
That's right, exactly.
Lead you guys up there and come down here once a week. Once a year. We're playing Aston.
Commissioner Gary Bettman has proposed a compromise. It would move Toronto back into the east, but keep two high-profile Leafs games out west, against each of Calgary, Edmonton, and Vancouver. For the next 5 years, additional games would also be played against St. Louis, Chicago, and Detroit. In the end, the motion passes, with two abstentions.
It's the right result. It works for a lot of teams, and it's important.
I think it's terrific. I think it'll be good for Canadian television. I think it's good for travel. I think it's good that we were able to work it out.
The NHL can solve some Canadian team problems. Others, the NHL can do nothing about. Escalating player salaries is one of them.
There comes a time when... When...
10 years ago, Edmonton's Wayne Gretzky was sold to the Los Angeles Kings because Peter Pocklington said he could no longer afford to keep the Great One in Canada. Glenn Sather was the Oilers' GM there. He still is.
We pay, talking about the Canadian teams, the majority of our salaries in U.S. dollars. So we're paying almost 50% more than the American teams are. But there's no breaks for the Canadian teams. Calgary, Edmonton, Ottawa. Very difficult for us to compete.
Sather feels things are getting worse. This year, he and the Oilers may lose their star goalie.
We have a problem with Curtis Joseph. At the end of the season, he's going to be a free agent. You know, I've been trying to get him signed now for over a year. I've got to make a judgment on whether I keep Curtis throughout this whole year, this current year, or trade him. Well, if the American team wants Curtis bad enough, pay him whatever they want.
300 kilometers down the road, the Calgary Flames, unlike Edmonton, have a stable ownership. A nine-man consortium who are in it primarily for the love of the game.
Lots of tight shots of the ownership, I tell you. Get in tight on that chairman of the board.
The Calgary GM, Al Coates, still has to make do with the smallest payroll in the league.
Yeah. And he can't play in these two games.
That's right.
His overall strategy is to build a team with players that are mostly young and unproven. This year, he's begun to worry about re-signing the team's only star.
Highest bidder.
Well, I would like to stay in Calgary for sure, you know. But hockey's a business now, and I know Calgary's a small market team, and there's only so much money they're able to pay and afford to pay. And I'd like to think that, you know, there's a deal there somewhere where both sides can be happy. And, you know, all I know is Calgary, and my memories of Calgary are, you know, fond, you know. 89 Stanley Cup.
I think Fleury epitomizes a lot of things that are great about our game. And I hope we never lose Fleury, quite frankly, because nobody plays harder. I think when you're going to have one real good player like there in Fleury, you have to at least have two or three others. And so you're into several million dollars per player on a team. Now, are you better to go to that course, or are you better to have 20 guys that are a little bit maybe lesser in stature, but really compose a close-knit team, a team that's going to work together and hopefully emerge together? And to some extent, that's what we've begun here, and that's the process that we're in. La, 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 la,
la. Marketing man and broadcasting executive Ron Bremner is the Flames president and CEO. He's the one who has to set the team's budget.
These aren't signatures. These are opportunities. We're just doing everything we can twice as hard because we have to keep up with Ken Dryden and Brian Belmore and the Toronto Maple Leafs in that big market.
You know, if we can take in $4,000 a night from a suite times 40 games, it's $160,000 times two, that's $320,000. That's the left leg of a third line forward. So now what we have to do is go out and find opportunities to get the right leg. and we start working on the torso, and that's what you have to do. And you have to break it down. As somebody once said, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. And that's what we're doing. We're eating elephants every day here.
Back in Edmonton, the airwaves are full of ideas about how to save the Oilers.
Investment package together for the people of Edmonton so they could be...
What we have are 15 people holding one or more units at this moment.
For the ordinary Joe in Edmonton, like Green Bay did with Packers.
Yeah.
Do something like that.
The National Football League's Green Bay Packers have made their fans feel the team belongs to them by selling them shares. But Cal Nichols would prefer to limit ownership of the Oilers.
Yeah, well, they did this in Florida with the Panthers, and also it's been done just most recently in Green Bay with their football team. The thing is, I would prefer not to do it to the third year because of the limited partnership.
Nichols feels limiting ownership will ultimately increase the value of the team. That is, if there still is a team here in 2 days.
You can write a check for about $10 million, and that'll do it. That's all we need. I'll come over and pick it up.
I mean, our chances of finding, 100 people with $100,000 to get the $10 million that we need in the next 2 days, don't like the chances of that. I mean, we don't want people going out and breaking the piggy bank and borrowing money to do this because we can't guarantee them a return.
Imperial's management team wishes to advise that we decline the opportunity to participate in your proposal for the naming of Northlands Coliseum. Best of luck with your venture.
Today there's bad news on the petroleum place front.
We need money. Petro-Canada.
None of the big money oil and gas boys seem interested.
The equity guys in this deal that are putting their own money up have to look at this and say, I'm going to risk my money and find that the biggest corporations in Alberta aren't interested in commercial support. I mean, that's got to send up a red flag. You got to say, well, it's, you know what, maybe this isn't the right place for us, NHL hockey team.
The smart money may have given up on the franchise, but Edmonton's hockey fans are doing everything they can to keep the team in town.
Molson's win a dollar a dozen, we win a dime. We're small. That's what we can afford this time. We will do over 2,000 dozen out of this store alone. Hopefully that will make a difference. I believe it would just be an utter shame that we lost the team.
We've been donating $1 from every 10 wings sold, our chicken wing sales, and so far we have about $2,000 from that. Our 1998 All-Canadian Girls calendar, we've also donated $1 from that as well to go to the Save the Oiler Fund.
If you're in the States and you've got a team in trouble, you've got, you got 100 people that can step in, well, you're going to get somebody. In Edmonton, you got 10 people who can step in. Well, the odds aren't as good.
It'll be another Canadian team gone. You don't want that. You want to keep them there.
I mean, the Oilers sell out every game, and they can't afford to be here. It's sad. It's very sad.
Winnipeg, Quebec, we can't lose them more. Hockey's Canada, not the States.
You know the feeling. Some say it's just a game. But you breathe life into it. Anger, joy, admiration. It's how it makes you feel. It's not about the contracts, the crowds, or the glory. It's about staring fear in the eye and not giving in. Playing past the pain and going for it all. You make it what it is and what it will become. Strength, pride, courage. It's more than just a game. It's who we are. It's who we will be. It can unite a nation and define a country. It's our game, and nobody can take that away. It's tradition. Keep it alive. The one and only Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
Even Even in a shinny game, you can find him. The kid who can just flat out play better than anyone else.
And every second person has an outdoor rink. It's just something they would do on a, you know, after school or an evening. Just get out there in the outdoor rink or a lot of the man-made lakes here. And, you know, it's just packed with kids playing shinny. Or...
I've made backyard rinks.
In Saskatoon, the kid is Jarrett Stoll. A lot of people say he's the next Wayne Gretzky.
This is the gold medal that Jarrett's team won at the Western Canadian Bantam Championships.
Just 15, he's already got an agent.
This year the agent started, and that was a whole new part of the game, including myself. I didn't realize or understand that there's some real good ones out there, but there's some poor ones out there. And Jarrett has selected his agent. I narrowed it down to two or three, and I left him decide after that.
He's had a real good game. He's playing at a level here where he's a year younger than everybody else in the tournament, and he's a real pivotal guy, you know, on their team, playing the point and the power play. He's a real good player.
Stoll's outstanding offensive abilities make him the exception to the Canadian rule. One of the many problems facing the Canadian game is that homegrown skilled players are fast becoming an endangered species.
Good to see you, buddy. Congratulations. Well, how about you guys
going? We start young age all the time. We're out on the ponds all the time, and after supper, Christmas, we're always skating. We always got our blades on. So I don't know, just maybe more opportunities to the rinks, little towns. Like, I came from a little town when I was younger. We could get on the ice anytime we wanted to, so it really helped me out down there. And this just helps out the Saskatchewan boys because it's all little communities.
I don't think it'll ever die, it'll ever die in the prairies. Little kids still have the dreams, I guess.
If Jarrett Stoll goes as high as expected in the NHL's 2000 entry draft, it'll be because NHL Central Scouting put him there.
653 X4.
Van Beeskirk.
We go through it early December, now in the middle of January, and then our final ranking is in late April, early May. Our scouts will see an average of about 125, 130 games a year.
Kook over Levesque, Levesque over Kook.
The league scouts meet three times a year to rank the North American talent pool.
He's got to improve his skill level. But
lately, what they've been seeing out of Canada really isn't reassuring.
The players we're discussing right now, it looks like about 60-40 for a Canadian as opposed to U.S. We're getting more U.S. players all the time.
A generation ago, 90% of all NHL players were Canadian. Today, it's 60% and dropping, with most elite players coming from the United States and Europe.
That's enhanced the U.S. Development a great deal.
For 19 years, Murray Costello has overseen all hockey development in Canada. He worries that Canada is turning out too many grinders and not enough playmakers. He thinks he knows why.
The one concern that is a very big one is the ratio of practice to games in our system. Parents like to see their kids compete, but not in practice. Coaches are judged on win-loss records at the earliest ages, not on practice teaching. For kids, practice isn't as much fun. They're ready to compete all of the time. But you don't do much teaching in games, and we compete all of the time. I think that's really unhealthy, and somehow we've got to tone that back, cut it back, and get into the practice session so we can really teach, and to leave time for shinny, you know, just playing with the puck and get the creativity back in the game. Give them the chance to really enjoy playing, have fun doing it.
If Canadian junior hockey ever does manage to turn itself around, it'd be nice if there were some Canadian teams left to play for. Right now, it doesn't look as though Edmonton will be one of them.
Bob, it would be one of the most important contributions made. I mean, that would be the thing that could take this thing over the top. Well, on a standalone basis, one U.S. a year.
That's better than nothing.
So this is down to perhaps they stay, they go time. And I'm sitting at table number such and such, and if there's anybody there that could pitch in denominations of $1 million or more, come and see me quick.
For the past couple of years, Canadian team owners have been meeting privately with the commissioner to discuss their common problems and possible solutions.
So how are you doing, Commissioner?
Your parking, great.
It's good. Yeah. Competition is a beautiful thing.
I go to every build.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Okay, I listen, I watch, I talk to the fans, and I watch three or four games a night. I know what the problem is.
Yeah. You're right.
They have a room ready.
We were jealous.
Yeah.
Most people running their own buildings now. An opportunity to try and help with events and marketing, ticketing, and ways of helping one another out. You know, with Montreal's doing a really good job with their building, bringing events in. We need that in Calgary. So does Edmonton, Ottawa. So I think the sharing of information is really what's paramount.
You know, I know you got a fistful of problems, but he's the guy I'd like to have on the other side trying to fix it for me.
I think we're paying for the room, so we'll say sit down.
Yeah.
Should we get going, gentlemen, if we can?
Whenever the question of small market team revenues crops up, Gary Bettman likes to talk about the NFL.
See, had long been saddled with a reputation.
The Green Bay Packers are a small market team. They not only won the Super Bowl last year, they had an operating budget of $78 million U.S., $60 million more than either the Edmonton or Calgary hockey clubs. Why? Every NFL team gets a share of the league's $17.6 billion television deal over 8 years. Canadian NHL team owners are convinced it has to happen here.
If you get a third of the deal that the NFL got, it'd be wonderful for us. But we have to have a major television contract in order to survive. I'm talking about the Canadian teams. That's going to be the saving grace of the Canadian teams at some stage, especially Calgary, Edmonton, and Ottawa.
Nobody has to have us yet, but that's what we're working to.
The commissioner believes the NHL's big American TV deal is just around the corner.
The good news is, in an era of fragmentation, networks need something special that differentiates them. Live sports is those special thing. So from our standpoint, people want to have sports. Okay, we're not comparable, nor is the NBA or baseball to the NFL. But it proves the point that it's sports is good programming. The NFL is in a class by itself. The NBA did well. And if we continue to grow and we're desirable programming, then our shot in the barrel will come also.
While they wait for that shot in the barrel to materialize, Canada's small market teams must focus on more mundane matters, like getting to the game.
That's it. Well, I didn't even look. I'm assuming it's probably just as bad. Oh, my sainted aunt.
Western Canadian teams must pay triple
league, right?
Or more for their travel compared
ABC,
to teams in the East.
So B's are middles.
It's understandable that the Oilers can't afford their own jet or charter flights.
We never get middles. We get about.
But the savings they make by flying commercial cost the team in other ways.
The decision has to be made between $2 million to go toward a player or operating the team as opposed to flying on a charter plane. The decision is fairly easy to make.
Did anybody see Cujo? You seen him?
The teams that charter probably have at least a 5 to 10 point leg up on everybody else that doesn't. Here, this is way too late to be arriving for flights.
Travel fatigue adds up. By the end of the season, it can cost a team a playoff berth or mean an early playoff exit.
It's not an easy way, and it certainly does have a bearing on how you perform over a long period of time. You do this for a year, and it's exhausting.
Are you still at home, do you think?
No one that has controlled the purse strings for the Edmonton Oilers has done this with any malice. It's just a grim reality of economics. You only have so much money coming in, and instead of spending $1 million a year on airfares, you're spending $3 million. That's what a charter adds to your bottom line expenses. And if you buy a plane, like LA did and Vancouver has, it adds $10 million.
Check him off too.
Because I want to know what this, if there's one bag missing, I have to know the number. Is it better to sign another player or give in on a contract to keep that player in Edmonton? or do we charter? I don't know. Maybe we should get the players to chip in. I don't know.
The real problem we got right now is that we're short somewhere around $10 million of equity, and I don't know where we're going to find it in 48 hours or less. But
for the local oiler investment team, the countdown has now begun in earnest.
Jesus, if we can just get
48 hours left, and they still haven't raised the money.
With another half a dozen guys from around town, we'll get her made. And
local investors must know that in today's NHL, you can put a good team on the ice, fill every seat in the house, build a new arena, and still lose money. They must also know that doing anything less is not an option. Montreal recently spent $230 million on Molson Center. Edmonton, prior to its current troubles, renovated Northlands to the tune of $30 million. Calgary's Saddle Dome renovation cost $37 million. Vancouver's GM Place cost $160 million. And then there's the Correll Center in Ottawa. Built in 1996, it cost $215 million. It has lots of corporate boxes.
Most buildings don't have that level of suites. Most buildings are between 80 and 120 suites, and they're all at the two levels we have them. See, we've got 100 there, and we've got, I mean, we're all sold out now.
Even the Toronto Maple Leafs feel they have to move. Maple Leaf Gardens may be paid for. It may have tradition. It may be intimate. But it was built in the Depression. Hockey fans have moved on.
We have to move because we need a bigger space that has more seats and more corporate boxes and more amenities, you know, for a fan. And those are the things that translate into the revenues that allow you to sign players and to keep players. I think as well as that, times change, people change, tastes change. People have said, I'd like a seat that's a little bit bigger. Why do I have to sit in a wooden seat? I don't sit in wooden seats at home. Why do I have to eat lousy hot dogs and stale beer? Just as Maple Leaf Gardens took the fan of Toronto of 1931 and put him into circumstances that were consistent with his circumstances of 1931, so will Air Canada Centre put the Toronto fan of 1999.
Some people have...
Morning, yes, sir.
How are you?
This year, the business of hockey has finally become a matter of public debate.
Thank you.
Canadians are worried about losing their teams. Canada being Canada, a parliamentary subcommittee has been struck to investigate. Commissioner Gary Bettman and the six Canadian team owners come to Parliament Hill for the hearings.
It's the beginning of the process of trying to prove to the world or the Canadians that we're not loaded, because we start off at 35% deficit right off the bat.
So it's at that kind of backward.
In the United States, it's different. The Florida Panthers' new rink costs $270 million. The county pays for it. The Buffalo Sabres finance their new facility with $15 million from the city, $22 million from the county, and $36 million from the state.
I thought it was outstanding. I mean,
the commissioner and the Canadian NHL team owners would like to see things like that happen here.
And welcome to our continued hearings on the industry of sport in Canada. To Mr. Bettman, maybe you would properly introduce those colleagues that are with you.
On behalf of the entire National Hockey League, I would like to thank you for inviting our six Canadians.
There were really only two points we were seeking to get made and acknowledged. The first is that NHL hockey is an important business and economic engine. There are 11,000 jobs that are attributable to NHL hockey in the arenas. There's $1 billion of private money that was invested in infrastructure improvement in Canadian communities, that there's a couple to $300 million a year in taxes that our teams pay, and that therefore we wanted a recognition that we're more than just some sport,
that we are an important business.
It's not a market problem. It's a Canada relative to U.S. tax and public policy problem, and I hope this committee will at least notice that it's true and ask the government to do some real analytical work to recommend what to do about it.
So are you saying
what Dennis Mills' committee will do, I hope, is to set in context of why North America is absolutely critical to Canadian professional hockey. It would be absurd to say, well, let's just draw a line across at the parallel and we'll play hockey in Canada, lots of people to watch it. But it would not be the same. It matters that the New York Rangers are coming here tonight. It matters that you're part of the best in the world, not just the best in Canada. But if we're going to do that, we have to find some way to have the playing field not so completely uphill that the best players can't be held at the top of the hill. They just always run down to where the money is. And to do that, one can either find some way to tell the United States that you should legislate something to prevent subsidizing pro sports teams. Good luck. Or we can find some way to impose fewer public burdens on Canadian pro sports teams.
Kind of astounded when you find out that Ottawa had to pay for their own turnabout, you know, off the Trans-Canada Highway to get into their building. It's the only one that any private industry has paid for in this country, from border to border. It's the only place. And, you know, the money that Montreal has paid for the Molson Center, the taxes they pay in that place is astounding.
We have given the three level of government last year $30 million in different taxes. This includes the GST, the Quebec sales tax, the building tax, the business tax, and the capital tax. This is all revenue for the three level of government, and they don't have to invest $1.
The issue is, are our teams being taxed into oblivion? The Montreal Canadiens spent $250 million of their own Molson's money to build a brand new state-of-the-art building in downtown Montreal, the biggest piece of privately funded construction in Montreal in the last decade, and in return for which they get taxed at three times the rate of all the teams in the United States put together. That's not about us getting our house in order. That's not about us healing ourselves. That's about whether or not that team and that building have been fairly treated.
Is that sports?
The idea of NHL teams seeking government assistance offends some Canadians.
We thought of sports as a world apart that lived by a different set.
It won't affect Ken Dryden in a large market like Toronto, but he can see a bleak future for the small market Canadian teams if changes are not made.
What you can start to see happening in sports is teams that you say they will never win a World Series. They will never win a Super Bowl. There is no possibility of them winning a Super Bowl or an NBA championship or a Stanley Cup. And you want never to get to that point.
Are we there on Canada?
We're not there, but we are we're treading around the edges, you know, in some cases.
Edmonton's situation is again a case in point.
They certainly have some good young kids there, but will they ever be able to compete for a cup if the costs are so tightly watched? I don't know, the kids are probably, when their contracts come up, if you ask Glenn Sather in Edmonton, you know, the kids want to get out of there after 3 or 4 years. Glenn's very much tried to control his payroll so that he can afford to keep the team in Edmonton, and he can't keep them there.
If the debate begins and ends with the point that you're not economic engines, you don't provide jobs, you don't provide tax dollars, you have no economic consequence, if that's the conclusion, then we can end the discussion. But it can't be the conclusion, because there is an important, you just have to look at the communities they're in, there is an important economic component of what our teams provide.
If this issue was a Toronto issue, if the Toronto Maple Leafs were leaving Toronto on the same, you know, under the same kinds of conditions and economic kind of duress, I'll tell you, they'd be lining up on Bay Street at King to say, well, what do we do to help? You know, what can we do to help? And we got to fight and scratch and say, geez, we're out here 2,000 miles away, but we also have 5 Stanley Cup banners up there and a history and a legacy, and we need your help. And so far it ain't working. So there's only one group of guys now that are going to make this call, and that's
the guys that are going to be sitting around tonight till all hours, looking at each other and saying, are we going to go or not? And if we're going, boy, we're taking some huge risks.
For Cal Nichols, his lawyer, and the rest of the local Oiler investment team, the decision to go ahead with the purchase comes down to a last-minute, late-night meeting.
We'll have some additional things to do, and we hope to be able to finish them tonight and tomorrow. And if we're successful, we'll have a press conference. But I've said, even if we aren't successful, we'll have a press conference tomorrow through the ED offices, and they'll get in touch with everybody, give everybody lots of notice.
And how long are you guys going to be here, sir?
Who knows? Maybe all night.
Do you know, Mr. Mayor, if in fact they have enough money right now?
At 8 the next morning, Nichols gets ready to make a public announcement.
I can do that. I can have lived that. But what I want to do is just...
good afternoon, everyone. And
he's learned some hard lessons about small market team reality these past few months.
Encouraged us.
He's not sure an act of parliament is required to save hockey in Canada. But he does feel the league ought to do something.
I think there has to be some form of rationalization in salaries, because if it continues to escalate the way it is, I don't think Edmonton is the only team in the league that's going to be in trouble. I think the whole league is going to be in trouble, and the more they let this go on, the more they're driving it to a multi-tier hockey league without really telling the public that they've done it.
In the end, Cal Nichols has found not one or two, but 35 local investors. At a cost of $1 to $5 million each, they are prepared to make a leap of faith.
What we try to do is sell it on the basis of community first motives as opposed to for profit. And I like to refer to the group that we have brought together as really the blue collar millionaires of this market, because many of them, they just are people who worked hard, got in the trenches, rolled up their sleeves, and have been very, very successful in manufacturing and distribution and in some of the oil field supply companies. So there's not anybody in this group that are junk bond dealers or a lot of major corporations. These are really grassroots millionaires that are participating in this project.
I think the plan is to keep it here forever. Small market, make it work in a small market. And I think if we can make it work here, we'll set a real precedent for Canada, for Canadian hockey. And we really, you know, it's our part of our culture and our heritage. So let's keep her here.
Okay, is everybody ready?
Edmonton's hockey community has been forced to choose between good business sense and its heart. Unable to see the team go the way of Winnipeg and Quebec, the community has come down on the side of its heart.
So we're just waiting now.
Good afternoon, everyone, and I would like first to thank you all for coming and being with us. This is going to be a great day for Edmonton. As of this afternoon, the Edmonton Investors Group delivered an offer and the required deposit to purchase the Edmonton Oilers. I want you to know that our group of investors
When news of the Oilers' sale to local buyers reaches Glenn Sather and Peter Pucklington in Palm Springs, California, neither seems overjoyed.
It takes money to be competitive in the NHL today. They've, you know, struggled to get enough money to be able to buy the team, and now if they're going to give us enough to operate it so that we can be a major league franchise is one thing, but if it's a band-aid solution, then it's not going to solve itself, because it'll surface again in 3 or 4 years.
Maybe they know too much about what lies ahead.
The local group of 15 or 20 people and with a big bank loan are going to try and keep hockey in Edmonton. I wish them Godspeed. I hope it works for them all. I do know they're going to have some losses, or they're going to have to cut their payroll to where they might disappoint the fans with a team that might not show up on the ice. So they've got a real dilemma.
skyrocketing players' salaries, heavy taxes, a declining Canadian dollar. The problems facing the new owners are massive and ongoing. But for now, it's mission accomplished in Edmonton. The Oilers didn't win the cup this year, but they did manage to survive.
I do it because one day I'll be the best.
I do it because I want to give something back to the game.
I do it for my dad.